size of the event, and we decided to go coast to coast. So in 2014, we actually made it into a national event, and we partner up ever since with great community partners. So all the accelerators, the incubators, any pro entrepreneurship groups that would actually make this a hit, make us actually tap into their network, connect with you guys, entrepreneurs, funders, and partners, and help us gather every single one of the people that are interested in entrepreneurship and growing their business in the cities that we went to. So this is really our background. Every single stop has two segments usually. We really try to make it educational. The mission of the Fundica Roadshow is to educate, inspire, and fund entrepreneurs across Canada. And so typically we have this room split into two. So we have road talks, so educational speakers, fireside chats, that entrepreneurs would actually come in and listen to. And then we typically select up to 20 pitching companies that would pitch their business to funders, a panel of funders, mentors, and advisors to get feedback to validate their business. However, this today, we were actually going to have the pitches live. So all of you guys will get to hear the pitches. You'll get to hear the funders' feedback. And at the very end, you'll also get to hear more pitches from the Founders Institute Toronto chapter, and you'll get to select, you'll get to be play the judge and get to select the best pitching company from the Founders Institute cohort, and they'll get a cash prize. So we're actually going to be having 10 pitches out of the Fundica Roadshow. So the Founders Institute are a different batch. At the end, you'll only get to hear them talk. They're great pitches, and you're going to get to hear 10 pitches throughout the day. So the panel of funders here and mentors will be actually grading them on the following criteria. So the team, the solution, the quality of the pitch, their market potential, and their readiness for San Francisco. At the end of the day, the panel will actually select one winner. So it's going to be our 12th winner. And they'll get to go home with a round-trip airfare to San Francisco. They'll get to pitch to VCs and angels in the Valley. They'll also get 3 months office space courtesy of Expansion Quebec in the Valley. And they'll also get a mega cloud hosting package provided by Canary and IBM. And they'll also get a free year of QuickBooks Online and a free R&D tax credit assessment by R&D partners. We haven't forgotten about any of you guys that don't get to pitch or don't get to win anything. Not anything. You're winning knowledge here today, right, guys? And so if you go on fundicaroadshow.com/perks, you'll get 50% off QuickBooks for free accounting solution. You'll also get 1 free year of Canary cloud hosting solution. IBM is also offering 1 free year of cloud services, and Netherus will be waiving their implementation fee, so it's a payroll service solution, and they'll actually be providing the 13 month for free. So I'm gonna ask my co-host here, who was taking a seat, to actually come up and introduce himself. So Mike Lee, president of Fundica, also co-host. Yeah. And
good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
So I'm here to kind of tell you a little story about how we've kind of worked and what we've done with our partners. We're very fortunate to have some great partners. One of our original partners is Canary. Here's Randy, and I think we have an individual as well from Canary here.
Ella,
okay. All right. Eric, okay. So we're gonna learn more about Canary. Free service, always free, great service. They've been a supporter of us from the beginning, so thank you for that. And really what Canary is about is getting Canada into kind of further into the digital age. So a great service, and I'd say as well as a service, also some great people that can help you along the way. So it's Canary. IBM, a newer partner for us, kind of a good add-on to Canary. In fact, very easy to migrate from Canary into IBM. It's pretty much easy to come in out of Canary into any other one, but IBM is a good solution to go into next. They're really for once you're in the commercialization phase. Interesting one for us, because originally Fundica was hosted on a large and a well-known hosting platform, but we had poor service. We had some downtime, and we actually spent a lot of time refactoring code to speed up the site. Last year, we moved to IBM, haven't had one downtime. We no longer have to worry about speeding it up. The site is quite rapid. And most of all, the customer service is fantastic. So we're very happy. So, you know, kind of proof that it works well. We're using it. It's great. And they also offer a lot of other services as well, which we'll learn about today. PayPal, a great partner as well, and also someone that we've worked with from the beginning. So when we started Fundico, we have a paid version on there, primarily used by accountants and lawyers at this point. We tried different solutions. We looked at different solutions. We came back to PayPal. And why do we love it? It works well. It's trusted. It's transparent. And you know, when you're talking about payment, you don't want to mess around. And I got some solution that nobody knows and nobody trusts. It works well. We've always been happy with it. It's kind of a no-brainer. Netris, a new partner for us. Payroll processing is what they do, so it really help you payroll process. Payroll processing to me is also kind of a no-brainer. Everyone should be using payroll processing. Doing yourself manually opens it up. It takes more time. It's costly. And you may also have some problems down the road, but it's just one thing you don't really need to think about. It's easy. It's set up. And their solution is completely web-based, very easy to do, very easy to work with. A number of companies, the roadshow so far, have started using it and are very happy. So these are some of our partners. Other partner is QuickBooks. So QuickBooks is presenting partner. A story with them. So when we started, I guess we were like most entrepreneurs. We started and we did our accounting on Excel. And it wasn't something we really thought about proactively. We just did it when we kind of had to. It's taxes time. It's for some reason we have to get this done. And then we moved to a desktop version. We won't need to go in the name of it, but we went to a desktop version. That seemed to help a bit, but not necessarily that much. Then we moved to the cloud. We went from 3 days at the end of every month, to, you know, doing all our bookkeeping, to less than half a day. Automates a lot. Pulls in all your credit cards. It pulls in all your stuff. It really makes things a lot easier. It's quite intelligent. And again, I actually believe this kind of web-based version, so QuickBooks Online, it's faster, it saves you money, but it's also more reliable. And I believe actually you're more less likely to have any kind of problems because you can access it anywhere, allow access to other people, and you can also add in other services. So another great product. And we're very lucky to have these different partners, which not only support us, but support the whole entrepreneurship community here. So thank you for being there for us.
And I'd like to personally thank, so thank you, Mike. And I'd like to personally thank Mars and Startup Toronto, as well as all of our great partners. So he mentioned that their partners, this is when I thank team, it's an extended team. Those partners have been great to us. None of this would be possible without their energy, their support. They're so engaged and supportive of us. If it doesn't work for us, it doesn't work for them. And they have always been so resourceful. They would connect us with all of the network to like make it actually, you know, successful and a hit. So all of these partners, MetaBridge, CFC, Idea Boost, Expansion Quebec, Slingshot Voice over IP, Startup Canada, Concierge, Blake's, Founders Institute, The Working Group, LATAMS, Research Money, Investor Onto, Incubes, Socialite, DMZ, NCFA, Tech Alliance, WeTech Alliance, Startup Peel, and the Rick Center. All of these guys have played a major part. And a big, 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 big thank you to our co-hosting partner, Startup Toronto, Craig Major. Give him a big, big clap, guys.
All right.
Thank you, guys. So you guys have met us. I'm just going to ask the partners to actually come out really quickly so you guys put a face to their name. They're going to be in, you know, the cafeteria room and CR2 as well, where there's going to be, you know, cupcakes, candy, food for you guys to interact with them. And, come on, guys. Randy, Kevin, Melise, Pierre, David, the partners, only the national partners come up. Domenico, perfect. So we'll start with David because he loves it when I put him on the spot.
It's the best ever. Hi, everyone. Dave from QuickBooks. I think Mike nailed it, so I don't really have to give the pitch. But stop by our booth. We can talk about the product or the startup finance boot camps that we're putting on with Startup Canada across the country. But thanks to you guys for having us out once again, and I'll pass the mic up.
Thank you, David.
Good morning. I'm Pierre Saint-Arnaud from Netris. Mike described what is a payroll service, and later this morning I'm going to discuss with you the risks that are related to payroll management. I'm here with my partner from National Bank because they're distributing our software, our payroll solutions. So if you have any questions, we're going to be in the next room. And just keep in mind that a payroll service is not for large enterprise, it's for anything from one employee up. So this is what we're going to talk about this morning. Thank you.
Hi there, Maylise Craig from the National Research Concierge Service. So I represent the government with respect to accessing innovation programs. So for free, you can pick up our pamphlet next door. For free, you can call into our 1-800 number and get connected to an advisor such as myself. We're typically kind of engineering background, business background, haven't worked in government before, but we understand what it's like for entrepreneurs to try to figure out what government program might suit them and might help them to the next step. So really, it's that 30-minute conversation that helps guide you and helps warmly connect you with our government program partners. And typically, the people that would be represented by our innovation programs are those that would be applying for the CRA, Scientific Research and Experimental Development Tax Incentive. So that's the kind of folks who we can typically help with our program guidance. Thanks.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Kevin Zmenikis, and I do business development for PayPal here in Canada. I'd like to thank everyone for having us here. PayPal operates in 200 countries. We process payments of all different kinds. I'm happy to answer questions on any e-commerce. How does this work? I want to accept credit cards. I want to do A, B, and C. I'll be over there the whole day. And please ask questions. Thanks.
Well, good morning, everyone. My name's Randy Jones. I'm with Canary. Canary is an Ottawa-based not-for-profit that supports research, education, and private sector across Canada, and we've been doing that since 1993. We run five programs ranging from operating a backbone network for researchers to share data to funding development of research software. We have a Research Data Canada program to share the outputs of research, and an identity management service, and a infrastructure as a cloud service. So I'll be speaking about that at 11 o'clock. So in summary, Canary is about building digital infrastructure for Canada's future. Thank you.
What a nice segue, because after you do the public funded cloud, I'm with IBM, Steve Perelgut. You already heard our pitch, so I don't need to do anything or say anything. I think that was about as good as I could say it. You want a job marketing? We could probably do that too. We're over there also. We're talking about things we offer startups. A year with for smaller startups in the early phases, $2,000 a month of credits. For larger startups who are further along, you can apply for $10,000 a month of credits. So basically, we're going to take you to the next step.
All right. Thank you, Steve. So thank you all of you, and go to them today, use them, they're here. Some great advice from all of them. And make sure to connect, make sure to see what's there, make sure to see how they can help you. That's what they're here for. So thank you very much, partners.
All right, so who's ready for the first fireside chat? Come on, guys. Who's ready?
Woo!
Okay, great. So if you guys are ready, we're going to kick off the first fireside chat, which will be on how to fund your startup. Actually, let me do this. Okay. So it's going to be comprised of, it's going to be moderated by Craig Major from Startup Toronto. It'll include Omar Dalla from Real Ventures, Kevin Clemens from Class Capital, and Dom Bartolucci from The Working Group. So let's give them a warm welcome of applause. And so just a brief introduction about Craig Major. So Craig works extensively in the Toronto startup and entrepreneurial community as the program director of Startup Toronto. He's also the senior program manager and entrepreneur with experience working in many fields and a background of specializing in IT and business projects.
Want me to grab that for you?
So sure, we have, please welcome over our panel members, Dom, Omar, Craig, and Kevin. Please take a seat.
I'll just hold that for you. Thanks.
Well, I hope you'll come visit the Startup Toronto booth a little bit later and talk to me about what we do here in the city and how we represent Startup Canada and how we work with partners like Intuit. And we'll be hosting some of their finance boot camps here in the city in the fall. But let's get started with the panel. Let's start with introductions.
Hi, everybody. I'm Omar Dahl. I'm a venture partner with Real Ventures. Real Ventures is a seed stage investment fund. We're on our third fund, which is just sub $90 million. We invest primarily in Canada. The firm started in Montreal and about 2 years ago established a presence here in Toronto with a particular focus on making investments in Toronto-Waterloo. Over the last 18 months or so, we've made about 15 investments in Ontario, so we've been quite active, primarily at the seed stage, so pre-Series A.
Hey everyone, I'm Kevin Kleimans. I'm an associate at Class Capital. Our office is just across the hall here. We just moved into Mars, which we're excited about. We're a venture firm, growth equity firm focused on enterprise software. We provide growth capital and we also acquire companies. And we have 15 enterprise SaaS companies today.
Hi, I'm Dominic Bortolussi, founder of The Working Group. We are a digital agency. We build web and mobile software platforms and products. Been around for about 14 years now. We're down the street, Spadina and Adelaide area. And we've worked with everyone from startups all the way up to enterprise. And about 6 years ago, we started strategically investing in some seed stage startups and helping them with their product development and their design. And we really enjoyed it. The team really enjoyed it, so we kept doing it. And so that's a small piece of our business, but we're pretty active in the startup community in Toronto.
Great, thanks. We might as well start with you, Dominic. Can you describe the state of Toronto's startup community?
From my micro view, because you know it's a big community in the GTA, I think it's quite healthy right now. I think we're seeing a bit of a crunch in terms of funding. I see the public markets are very questionable right now. People are a little bit worried, and I think that trickles down into the thinking of the fund managers and the people that have money to invest in startups. So I think there's a bit of a shakeup going right now. We were just talking about this outside about how it seems like institutional investors and the largest VC investors are becoming extremely cautious. Meanwhile, the angel world is just starting to get caught up here in Toronto and is perhaps a better bet for the really early stage companies to find funding. They're not maybe quite not as nervous as the bigger the bigger investors right now these days. So
I definitely agree with that VCs are being very cautious right now. I think it's a pretty broad question, so if you have to narrow it down into kind of sub-segments, if you're an enterprise SaaS company doing over $1 million in revenue, I could name 7 or 8 VCs that would be very willing to fund you. There's a lot of funding at that Series A stage right now for enterprise software, for consumer technology, for hardware, for other segments. I wouldn't say it's as good as it is in Silicon Valley or other areas. So I think we can definitely use some improvements in different areas. It needs to be broken down into kind of which segments are healthy and which aren't. It's good having support systems like Mars and Fundica, but we need even more micro support systems for different communities and segments within technology, I think.
Same question?
Yes.
So, you know, my take on the community, having spent the better part of the last 5 years with early stage startups as an operator and now as an investor, is that increasingly there are higher and higher quality people entering the startup space. So I think that's a very positive thing. And I'm hopeful that continues. That being said, I would say in Canada in particular, we're still fairly inexperienced from a startup standpoint, right? I mean, Mike McDermott of FreshBooks, who many of you have probably heard of, had an article or a quote in the Globe a month and a half or so ago that sort of indicated that we're still in the early days of our evolution as a startup community in Canada. And I think that's largely true. You know, I think we've had a lot of really strong stories over the last couple of years, but we've also been in a very favorable funding environment for entrepreneurs. And I think people have taken advantage of that and been able to grow companies. And I think largely that's a really good thing. I think that, to Dominic's point, has brought a bunch of angel activity into the market. And I think historically you saw angel investors who did not understand the phases and stages through which a company would need to raise capital from the early stage and therefore offered terms that frankly I don't think were fair to entrepreneurs. I think that trend has definitely shifted and you have a lot of really active angels in the market. I think if I was an entrepreneur today, I certainly would be talking to smart angels, angels who understand early stage investing, who understand the business or the problem you're trying to solve. But I would also be very cautious about, you know, thinking through valuation at every stage of investment. I think it's very tempting as an entrepreneur to give up as little as your company as possible at every stage. And therefore, what that means is to maximize your valuation. What you need to think through is, I'm raising money today. I may need to raise money in 12 months or 18 months. And I may need to raise money 12 to 18 months after that. And at each stage, I'm going to be diluting my company to a certain extent. You need to understand what the downstream funding landscape looks like such that you can make decisions today on how you fund your company. And I do think there's a stronger focus now on the economics of the business, to Kevin's point around SaaS businesses being attractive just because there's more predictability in those business models. But I think no matter what you're building, the one thing I'm hearing more and more in the community from entrepreneurs is a real focus on the fundamentals of the business, which I don't think is a bad thing, but I think is a change from where we sat probably 12 months ago, where early stage ideas were getting funded with relatively underdeveloped models.
So it sounds like there's a lot of growth and a lot of change here in the city. Do you have a vision of where you should be and what it's going to take to get there?
Yeah, I mean, I struggle a bit with this, you know, Silicon Valley North type mentality. I mean, I think we're unique. We have the Toronto Waterloo corridor, which I think is quite strong. I think we need to continue to do more and more to foster collaboration between these two markets. I think we have a real opportunity here to continue to build successful companies. Obviously, the big gap is scaling these companies beyond the early stage. So lots of really good activity at the early stage. But as companies get to the Series A stage, do we have the talent to help those companies continue to scale from Canada? So I think we need to be really proactive about bringing talented people back. And so, my vision is to start to help companies bring in that type of talent as they scale. And I've been involved in a couple of activities myself trying to foster that, but it's really hard. I mean, it's attractive for people to go down and work in the US. More opportunity, they typically get paid more, et cetera, et cetera. So we really need this common belief, common vision, common mindset that we're going to succeed from here.
Yes, for me, there's just one main thing that we need. And I think we need more IPOs here. In the States, what happens when you have IPOs is you get this effect, this natural cycle, where you get a talented team that builds up a company, sells it, then they'll go dip down to an earlier stage company and do it again. So you'll have second time, third time entrepreneurs building companies. For us, we have a pretty strong core of companies in the early stage, mid stage, but once they get to kind of over 100 employees, they tend to stall or they'll get acquired. So a lot of the executive management teams, a lot of the talent, they've never had experience building businesses from 100 to 200 to 300. So we need more IPOs, and I guess you need the floodgates to open. Once one happens, then it will lead the path for others. It's hard to be the first because it's never been done before. So if you're at that stage with 150 employees, you'll say, the odds are probably stacked against me. It rarely has been done. There's Shopify, but that's about it. So we need a couple more IPOs, I think.
Yeah, I think I would echo a few of the things that were just said there. I think the quality of people is the piece that we really need to develop here. And that's going to come from the FreshBooks and the Shopifys and the Kicks, learning what it takes to grow a business from 10 million to 100 million to a billion. I think that the return of the maple syrup mafia type of approach, where you've got people IPOing, having capital that they can then allocate to their colleagues and friends and startups that they know from 2 years back or 3 years back when they were just growing, is going to be really valuable, and then the insights that they will bring to those emerging startups is going to be key. So I think that's that a virtuous cycle that we're starting to see happen, hopefully from what we saw with Shopify. We'll see the spin-off effects of that. I see the key outcome from that is more risk-friendly capital going into startups, and then really excellent mentorship from people and leaders who have taken businesses from small to large.
Great. Kevin, let me ask you this question. Since more specifically to this type of events and maybe this type of crowd, should entrepreneurs change their pitch for different types of investors or US investors versus Canadian investors?
Right.
So I don't think investors should change their kind of their mission and their financial forecast for the investor. They should not tailor it to the investor, but they should change the approach that they use to pitch to investors based on what those investors' preferences are. So really understand what type of investor is this. Investors have different knowledge. So some will be more technical, some are more financial, and they'll focus more on unit economics. So even talking to some of their portfolio companies that have pitched to them successfully in the past, and understanding how to tailor your pitch to them and communicate to them effectively, I think is helpful. But you shouldn't waver on your mission and tailor it to the investor. Find the investor that fits your mission.
Same question.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think when you're building a company as a founder, pretty much everything you do is a sales activity, right? So you probably wouldn't sell to every customer segment similarly. Right, you tailor your message to each customer. I think when you're raising capital, you're running a sales process as well. And so, you know, one of the things we work a lot with our companies on is, you know, you've just raised some seed capital. Ultimately, most of our companies will want to raise a Series A. Thinking through not just the messaging by which they'll go raise that capital, but the various investors that make sense for the particular business they're building, right? The economics, to Kevin's point, that those investors look for. You know, I think you have to be very specific about who you're targeting from an investor standpoint. You always have to be out there having conversations, which, you know, I think puts the onus on having a really strong story and a really good understanding of your vision and a really clear way of articulating that vision kind of at the ready at all times. I think that's super important. But I think as you get deeper and start to engage with investors, it really is about understanding what those investors are looking for. And frankly, you know, finding fit with an investor group or, you know, understanding that a series of investors are probably a better fit for you than others is really important because you can waste a lot of time raising money. And, you know, one of the things that gets said a lot about Canadian investors is that we're too nice, right? That we, you know, we'll have a conversation with an entrepreneur and we'll say, oh, that's really interesting. You know, probably not for us. Let's talk in a few months. Is that a yes? Is that a no? You guys don't know, right? Well, that doesn't really help you, right? So I think, I know that I've frustrated and pissed off a lot of entrepreneurs by frankly telling them, sorry, we're not going to invest in you. And I would much prefer to have that tough conversation with you guys earlier than later and risk that I lose out on something special because frankly, every time I say no to anybody who's out there building their vision, something they're passionate about, I'm risking missing out, right? I mean, that's the risk I take. But I'd rather do that so you can go focus on people and firms that might fit than to give you the, hey, let's talk in a few months. If I tell you let's talk in a few months, I'll give you a reason why and I'll have a reason why I want to engage with you and I'll tell you what that is. Right, so I just think for you guys being really diligent on who you're talking to and why is really important.
So on that, I'm just going to elaborate a little bit. So how and when should entrepreneurs approach investors, and is it ever too early?
Too early? No, I don't think it's ever too early, unless you don't have anything more than just an idea on a piece of napkin. Even that maybe works sometimes. But I think what's important is when you're speaking with an investor, you got to cater your message to them, as we've been talking about. It totally makes sense. I think what you're trying to raise needs to be based on taking your business to the next level. So that probably shouldn't change. That should be set. You should have figured out what that's going to take and, you know, make an educated guess. And I would actually like to know from you guys, because I don't have this experience, but it would seem to me that if you're speaking to an investor in the States who has a particular interest in a certain area, you know, maybe you can justify a different valuation than you would up here. And does that look bad? Is that giving you a bad reputation if you try to raise here on a $5 million valuation and you go down to the valley and you try to raise on a $10 million valuation because there's more appetite? I was kind of curious about that. So I just hijacked your question because I was kind of dying to know about these. Yeah. I want to know, what do you guys think about that?
All right. I guess that's the new question on the table?
Yes.
Okay. So my opinion on valuation is that, first of all, you should have a valuation set when you go into a pitch. And you should know your valuation of your company. But you should also work backwards, figure out how much of your business you want to own. And that should determine what your valuation will be. So depending on if it's US or Canada. To me, differentiating between US and Canada, it shouldn't matter where they're from. You should have a plan. You should know how you want to allocate your resources, and then find an investor that fits that, whether they're in Canada or US. It doesn't really affect your business. And also be careful not to take too much money. Like we've seen, think of both the pros and cons. We've seen companies that take too much money. This happens more so in the States than in Canada. And a lot of companies are raising down rounds in the States right now. Also, assess your risk tolerance. Do you want to be, so when you raise a valuation, you have to grow into that valuation. You haven't earned it yet. You're getting validation that they're buying into your mission, but you have to grow into that, and that puts a lot of stress on an entrepreneur. So sometimes consider taking the right valuation as opposed to the highest valuation, I think.
Yeah, I mean, what I would add to that is, particularly at the early stage, and we were talking about this just before, you know, if you haven't really built anything and you haven't really sold anything, how do you know whether your valuation is $1 million, $5 million, or $10 million, right? You don't. And frankly, investors don't really know either. There's a market, right? And you have to understand what that market looks like no matter where you are, whether you're in Canada, US. Sometimes those markets look the same. Sometimes they look quite different depending on what you're raising for, what stage you're at, et cetera. So competitive dynamics will certainly drive, you know, valuations up, and they have over the last couple of years. But the thing I would be more focused on, to Kevin's point, is the amount of dilution you're taking at every stage of funding, right? So the typical rule of thumb is 15 to 20% per round. So if you think about what that means for your business as you grow it, you should really quickly be able to understand not only what your valuation should look like at each stage, depending on your capital requirements, but also, you know, how much of your business you'll retain as that business grows. I think having a clear understanding of that as you set out is really important. Now look, I mean, there are a lot of great examples of entrepreneurs who've gone out and created a market for their companies and therefore achieved a higher valuation and therefore less dilution. And I think that's great, right? That being said, to the point of needing to grow into your valuation, if you really optimize for that first round of funding and say you're able to achieve a really high valuation and then you don't perform, well, now all of a sudden you're raising capital potentially at a lower valuation than you previously raised at. And that really affects your company. That will affect your own motivation. It will certainly invest how your original investors perceive you. So I think thinking through stages of capital and incrementally growing your business and making sure that you're not taking, you know, you're not setting expectations too high for yourself is really important.
This is reminding me of like that golden triangle of like time, money, and quality when you're like building a product and like this thing's on. But you've got you know, valuation, how much you're gonna raise, and then your dilution. And because I've always approached it like you need to raise money in order to take your business to the next level, therefore you figure out how much money you need to raise. And then therefore your valuation and dilution follow from that. But to your point, you're saying, well, you know, you need to think about after multiple rounds of dilution, where do you want to end up being in that you know, list of owners? And then you calculate your valuation and the amount you're raising based on that. And I think there's a bit of a black art. You just wouldn't take one and you can remove the other two. So I'll hand it back to the regular scheduled program.
No, that was a fantastic wander. I think a lot of people like the information and probably will talk to you later about exactly how to dilute round after round, because it's a very common question I get. So it's not too early approach. Know your market, know the size. If you know your valuation, that's great. But what are the most common mistakes entrepreneurs make when looking for investments?
I think I'll speak to a bit of the last question and this one too. You meet a potential investor, you pitch them on your idea, and I think it's super valuable to keep in contact with them. Tell them what you're going to be doing. You know, often they're going to say, "Well, I'm not ready to invest in you right now. Call me back in 3 months." Or if they're nice, they'll say that. Or if they're not nice, they'll say, "No, we're not willing to invest in you." Maybe that's better. Yeah, that probably is better. But if you tell them what it is you're working on and what you're going to try to achieve over the next whatever 3, 4, 6 months, and then you contact them in 6 months and say, "Hey, remember we spoke. I was working on these things, and this is what I've achieved against these things. So I'm still moving forward. I'd like to talk with you again, or maybe another 6 months I'll be ready to talk with you again." Because investors want to see that you've got, that they've got a person who's got their head on their shoulders, they've got a plan, they've got a vision, and they're executing against that. All too often you'll have people who will run in, you know, are great visionaries with a great idea and, you know, pie in the sky, but as an investor, it's very difficult to determine whether or not they're going to be able to follow through. And so any evidence to show that, keeping in contact, don't bug them incessantly, but keeping in contact and letting them know how you're progressing is super valuable. And so it's a mistake, to get to your question, it's a mistake when entrepreneurs don't do that and they're trying to raise money.
So I'll focus my answer around the actual pitch to investors. So one common mistake, and maybe it's just a preference, we don't tend to like when companies come in with their slide deck and they have a slide that says, this is who's going to acquire us and this is how we're going to exit. It just seems a little premature for that. Like, we're just starting the conversation. We're looking to form a partnership and we're already talking about how we're going to get out of this thing and exit. So maybe it's a preference. I'd be interested to see your thoughts on that. And also, one common mistake, which may be a preference, is I think it's good to walk into a pitch meeting and ask the investor how do they want to format it. Sometimes investors don't tend to like to get pitched to or spoken to for 1 hour straight without it being a conversation. A big part of the pitch is seeing, are we able to work with this person? So if it's more of an informal conversation, you're able to assess that better. Obviously, come prepared with a deck, come prepared with a demo, but see how the investor wants to approach it. Kind of let them take control and maybe try and make it more of a discussion as opposed to a pitch.
Thanks. So I'll answer the question on acquisition versus other. I think, you know, we typically, you know, we invest, I think, a bit earlier than class does, but we certainly want to invest in people who are in it to win it, right? So I do think talking about acquisition is premature. I think talking about the ecosystem of companies against which you'll compete at scale, that's fine. That makes sense. That could imply an acquisition opportunity. But generally speaking, we want people who are in it to build, you know, big businesses. We know that won't always happen. And acquisitions are not bad outcomes in all cases. But I don't think that at the early stage when you're raising capital, talking about acquisition is the most relevant thing you can talk about. I think there are other things you can spend your time on. In terms of common mistakes, you know, I think we've talked a lot about a few of them, not knowing, you know, the investor, not knowing the audience, not understanding the fit between that investor and your idea. I mean, I think all of those are mistakes that are talked about quite a bit. You know, for me, you know, I think you should always be out there flirting, so to speak, right? You should always be out there meeting people. You should always be, you know, creating or at least driving the top of the funnel of your investment pipeline, if you want to call it that. But I think if you do that with an underdeveloped story, you're really shooting yourself in the foot. So it's different telling people, hey, I'm here, and in 6 months, I'm going to be there, and then executing against something that's fairly clear and well understood, and then coming back and delivering. I think that's a great strategy. I think it's very different to fumble around your story and go talk to people just because you think you should talk to people. So I see a lot of activity. I see a lot of people talking to entrepreneurs, or just talking to investors, sorry. You know, probably a bit earlier than they should, and probably without the rigor and thought that needs to be put behind a story. I think it's underappreciated how hard it is to articulate not just what you're building, but how you're going to build it. And I think I would like to see more time spent on developing that story, because frankly, if you can't articulate your story and your opportunity well to an investor, the first thing an investor thinks is, oh my God, how's this person going to run this business? Where's the strategy going to come from if this person can't communicate to me what they're doing, right? So I think that is one of the bigger mistakes I see.
Great. So we heard a lot of things already. Funding or non-funding related, what advice do you have for entrepreneurs here today? What are the keys to success? What are the things you've seen other companies do that set them apart? What advice would you give?
So I mean, I think number one, you know, build a strong business and understand the economics and fundamentals of your business at scale. I think that's super important, you know. And I think the other thing I would say to people is build relationships, right? If you're transactional with people, they will be transactional with you. That's true in every aspect of building your business, not just fundraising. So I think that you need to understand, again, you know, what the motivations and interests of, you know, the various people you talk to are with respect to your business, including investors, and just make sure that you're building quality relationships with those people. So if you can get a warm lead to someone, take the warm lead, right? Work hard to get a warm lead versus, you know, doing the kind of mass email blast and hoping for a response, right? Really be thoughtful about who you want to speak to and why you want to speak to them. And you know, be okay with engaging in a conversation with an investor that isn't only about whether that investor will give you capital or not, right? I think it's really important to focus on the relationship side of the business in all aspects, and investors are no different.
I guess I'll just echo kind of the point I discussed before about finding the right partner and valuation. The partner with the highest valuation is not always going to be the best partner for you. So think about that, and think about the pros and cons of taking a very high valuation and the pressures it puts on you, and the difficult decisions down the line that it could force you to make.
Relationships. So build yourself a team of advisors or a group of advisors. Often they may become investors. Find investors, find out if they're willing to help you, advise you, mentor you. That is a relationship process, super valuable. I've been on the receiving end of that, so like had really smart, talented entrepreneurs approach me and say, hey, you know, I'd like some advice on whatever it is, and I'm willing to have a conversation for sure, and then they, you know, they inspire me by how energetic and how ambitious they are, and I keep in contact with them, and lo and behold, you know, a year later, I make a small angel investment in them because I really believe in them, and they've shown me that they are able to, you know, follow through. That's super valuable. So the relationship side, and the other side is sales. You know, like, can you find a way to get a customer to pay for your product or service? So dual-minded focus, relationships with people who are going to be your investors and mentors and advisors, and getting to a sale, because everyone's going to like that.
So we talked about scaling somewhere in the middle, and you brought up scaling again. Can you give some advice on how to scale specifically here in Toronto, and how that might be different than the rest of the country or U.S. and the people you've dealt with?
Scaling. So one of the big advantages of the GTA, I think, is the talent pool. So we've got amazing engineers, amazing designers here, I think. And we're starting to grow a critical mass of product-focused, product management type of people, and that's key. And I think we were severely lacking in that department, you know, even 5-6 years ago. So now with the Shopify's and the FreshBooks and the rest of them coming up, we're going to see some stronger product management. So talent in GTA, advantage for us. Take advantage of it. Grow an excellent team here if you can. Other ways of scaling. You know, we all know about all the various forms of tax credits and government programs. Speak with Mike and Lana at Fundica and find out about like what is out there. There's a lot of sources of money out there that you can use. I'm curious to see what's going to be happening now with the new government, Liberal government, and what types of programs that they're going to be pushing ahead. I really like the one in BC where they've got the small business venture capital investment tax credit. I hope they bring that to the rest of Canada. I think that would really help angel investors make more investments and mentor the startups that they're working with. So I think, yeah, government funding and talent pool here is an advantage. Use those to scale.
So when it comes to scaling, you often a question people often ask is, when is the right time for me to raise capital? Like investors might give you some unit economics, say, oh, when your cost of acquisition reaches X, that's when you have to pour fuel on the fire and raise capital. But often that's just a magical number, and it's never achieved, and it's never as simple as it sounds. So it's never the perfect time to raise money. The first $1 million you spend is going to be spent a lot less efficiently than the next $1 million you spend. So there's going to be some growing pains along with that. So raising your capital in phases, because you know the first money you take is not going to be optimized in the way you spend it. And again, it all comes down to talent. So maybe one piece of advice, and we've seen it work pretty well with our companies, is don't be afraid to build your talent team remotely. So if you see a head of marketing, but they're based in Chicago, and they want to set up a team in Chicago, don't be afraid to take that path. There's a limited talent pool here in Toronto. Although it's very strong in Toronto and the GTA, there's a whole world out there of talent, and in the modern day, you could build a team remotely.
I mean, I think a lot of really smart things have already been said. I think with respect to scaling, you know, say beyond raising seed money, one of, there's a couple ways to think about it, right? Like, I think this idea of finding people in other markets and making them work with your org structure and your day-to-day process such that you can bring the talent in and keep them happy from a location standpoint is really important and something that everyone should be thinking about. I think the other way of thinking about talent as your company scales, and I've seen some Toronto-based companies do this really well, is just to identify really, really high potential people early. And even if you don't have a perfect vision for how those people will ultimately, operate within your company, bring them in and start cultivating them and surround them with the advisors and mentors that you're bringing around your company so that they get the coaching they need such that they can grow up with your company. And that can also be a very effective tactic, particularly in some of the business roles that, it's hard to go and secure that head of marketing or that head of business development or partnerships who's done this for a tech company in the US, bring that person back to Canada if that's what you're looking to do. So don't be afraid to cultivate the talent, but if you're going to do that, then be very clear on, the fact that the onus is on you as the founder and as the leader of that company to make sure that these people get the coaching and development that they need so your company is ready to go to that next level, right? So I think, think about talent management from day one and understand that you'll always be thinking about it, and particularly as you scale your company, how you surround yourself and your company with talent is going to be pretty critical to your success.
Great, and I have one last question. And this has to do with the people that are here today, and there are a lot of people are going to want to talk to you and several other funders here today. So if I was going to approach you today, and what should be my takeaway, and how would I get your attention, and what's the one thing I should try and get your attention today?
Wow. That wasn't in the list of questions before this. So there's a few ways. I talked about warm intros. Like, it's really nice to have an introduction from somebody who's sent me an email, said, hey, I'd like you to meet so-and-so person or so-and-so company. Here's what they're working on. And I've had the chance to take a look and say, hey, I'd love to meet that person. I think what they're doing might fit into, what we look for. And so just to understand why I'm meeting that person and to get, someone else who I know vouching for that person is really important. We have an open email address, hello@realventures.com. We'll look at any pitch deck. We literally go through every single one. And in probably greater than 50% of the cases, we'll set up a call with the entrepreneurs and have that initial conversation and provide as much feedback as we can. You can imagine we get a lot of those inbound requests, so we do our best to triage them and respond to folks that we think we can help. So that's another way to do it. And I think, again, going back to some of the discussion that's been had today, build a relationship. If you're sitting out in the crowd, for example, and you don't know, if you didn't know that Class Capital was an enterprise investor and you were building a consumer app, right, and you cornered Kevin and you said, hey, like, let me talk to you about my consumer app, and you held him there for 10 minutes to talk about it, and you didn't know that Class Capital didn't invest in consumer, well, then you'd be wasting your time, you'd be wasting his time, and you probably wouldn't be creating the best of impressions for yourself, right? So when you engage someone, just understand their motivations, their preferences. I think we've talked a lot about that, and seek to build that relationship.
I think that was well said. If you're an enterprise SaaS company, send me your pitch deck. It's as simple as that. Don't be afraid. Also, you don't always have to go to the managing partner of a VC firm. Associates and analysts, their job is to cultivate a pipeline of companies. So one of the questions before was, is it too early to approach an investor? One strategy is to build a relationship with associate or analyst. They'll plant a seed with that managing partner or the decision makers, but the associate analyst will follow your story. They'll make sure you're hitting your milestones, so don't be afraid to reach out to them. They're also very approachable.
Just say hello, and you can email me at accelerate@twg.ca. And be patient, because we're all really busy people, and I'd be happy to have a coffee with anyone or chat about anything, but sometimes it's going to take 2, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, and I'm still happy to do it. So don't think that everything has to happen today or tomorrow. Sometimes it takes a bit of time.
Thank you very much. This was great.
So they all mentioned coffee. Tea would also work. So just take the time, network with these guys. They're all very approachable, and they're all giving the time to come out and speak to you guys. So thank you guys all so much again. Thank you. So we're very popular today. So guys, let's all stand up together. We're going to just do a bit of aerobics. Grab your chair. We're going to make some room for the poor people on the side. Grab your chair, and we're all going to come forward. So grab your chair and come forward, please.
So just to go over quickly so everyone knows, we got a lot of questions on this at certain places. So the panel members are going to judge all the pitches. The way we do it is we take all their scores, we take out the high and low for each one and take the average. Generally speaking, the average is generally between, you know, say around 6 to 7. It's kind of the average we see, but by all means, grade them as you see them. Just stay consistent across so that it doesn't throw the averages too far off. Most important thing is that if there's anyone you have a conflict, perceived conflict, that means you know them very well, you're related, you're invested, you're thinking about invested, you're an advisor, you're an employee, anything like that, anything possible, please just do not rate them. That's the kind of the most important rule, perhaps. And it's really rated on, there's just 5 different categories there, as you see. So we'll go through the categories. Each one is 0 to 10, so maximum score would be 50. And again, we kind of see averages around the 6 to 7, so around 30-something. So I'm just giving this so that we kind of have similar judging going on. In terms of, and I think this is probably obvious to most of you, but just to kind of guidelines, there's some little things in the pitches, little slides, this and that. Those things are nice to bring up. We'll keep them kind of short and sweet. The most important thing is to try and provide feedback on the actual business, what they're doing, where they're going, the composition of teams, things like that, what they're the fundamental things that could help them. I think this is probably obvious to most, but just to keep us focused on that. And the other thing we'll try and do, because it goes pretty quickly, is try and keep, and this is for the, even more so for the pitchers than the funders here, is try and keep the going back and forth a bit, because we don't have a lot of time. So short questions, preferably shorter answers so we can get more of them in. So.
And we'll try to keep the questions and answers reserved to the panel members and the pitchers. I know you guys want to follow up with them, but you'll have the time to do it afterwards. Thank you.
Yeah, I think the way we'll do it, if they run out after 10 minutes, if there's really no more questions here, we'll go to the audience. But generally speaking, we're just going to end up with the funders.
All right. So the first pitch is Breezy. Warm welcome of applause. Thank you, guys.
Thanks, everyone. How's everyone doing? Good. Do we have sports fans in the room? Yeah, falling the rafters. So it's an exciting time. So my name is Anna Hu. I'm the CEO and co-founder of Breezy. And in the next 5 minutes, I will tell you how our technology is posed to change the state of the sports sponsorship industry in a powerful way. So, quick context. Number one, so fans. Fans are no longer engaged in the traditional go-to sponsorship assets inside sports stadiums. So I'm talking about the billboards and the billboards set up so that marketers can display their logos. When they're bored, they're engaged on their phones. Number two, brands that are advertising within the sports stadiums, they're sick and tired of paying top price dollars to be able to display their logos, right? And they are seeing the declining value of their millions of dollars of sports sponsorship spend. And they're looking to innovate within that space. And then finally, for the sports teams and venues themselves, they're looking to constantly innovate so that they stay relevant to their fans and they're still attracting the right type of brand partnerships. So that's a quick look there. And so, you know, when we talk about what makes great content and great marketing, it's really how we present that story. How do we storytell? And the best type of storytelling nowadays is when it's being told by the consumer or the fan that you already are engaged with. So this is already happening inside stadiums, but the question is, how do we tap into this authentic fan-generated content and be able to attach relevant brand messaging onto them? And that's what our platform does. So a quick overview. This is where it starts. Robotic fan cameras inside stadiums that thousands of fans can control for 30 seconds at a time with their mobile devices. So quick example, you're sitting in the stadium, pull out your phone, type in HeinekenFanCam.com, punch in your seat number, and in seconds, a camera will zoom to you and your friends sitting in the stands and will say, you're the producer. For the next 30 seconds, you can use your phone to pan, to zoom, to trigger a photo, and all of that, and you become part of the game experience. And what happens at the bottom line is that now we've got some really authentic fan-generated content that's really, really easy to brand. And once it gets shared to social, the amplification is huge. So you can take a look at some of the content that we've generated in our past events and sporting games. You can see that everyone's got actually holding a smartphone of some type in their hands. And they're actually controlling, they're triggering that photo being taken from across the stadium, a super unique angle, and a fun photo they can get really creative with and share with their friends from the event. And brands are willing to pay top dollars for this kind of experiential sponsorship, right? Because it's super creative and you can attach some authentic brand messaging to it. So overall, it's our market is we're in a $60 billion market in global sponsorship. And that brings us, where that puts us is a $300 million immediate size of market that we can capture right away. And that's only with our current product today, and that's only the first step of our product roadmap. So over the past 6 months, we've worked with some major brands, financial institutions, major alcoholic beverage brands, and to figure out, to determine what are the metrics that they use to measure sponsorship success. And so that's been really successful. And so last month, we signed our first NBA playoffs with the Portland Trailblazers, who now we've engaged in a long-term three-year partnership. So that's been really exciting for us. And their SVP even talked about us on a couple of TV interviews. He's bringing us on a panel and some of the marketing conferences that he'll be speaking to. So that's been awesome. And in this ecosystem, we've also built some really strong strategic partnerships. Quick example, Cisco is a network provider for almost all of the major stadiums and venues in North America. Our technology is actually set up in their innovation centers in their executive briefing space. So some quick numbers there. And you can see, this is the NBA playoffs that we did with some really, really capturing some really awesome content. Of course, I have to talk about our awesome team. Really strong backgrounds from BCG, Apple, Microsoft. All of our engineers come from product development inside startups for almost a decade's experience. And we're a lean team. We started generating revenue last year. We hit our six-figure revenue goal, and we were actually profitable on the books last year. And so right now it's about fast growth for us. It's about expanding our capabilities. So we're looking to raise $500 USD in a safe convertible structure, and almost all of that is filled now. So happy to open up the floor to any questions at this point. Thank you. That's a great question. So when it comes to media properties, right, you have companies like Facebook, like Snapchat, and Twitter, right, trying to capture that sports conversation. They're trying to make it happen all on their own platforms. Now, as the media property that's been around forever, the sports property, so the team and the actual owner of the content, they're saying, well, how do we monetize? How do we make digital a pillar of our revenue strategy? So by giving them a platform to let their fans generate content on their asset, right? It's their asset that they can now monetize. It's not going to Facebook or Twitter, who's now monetizing it through their own advertising channels. So it's a new type of digital asset for the sponsorship teams themselves. Does that make sense? Any other questions? Sure.
I could see pulling a prank on your friend when they have food on their face, just directing the camera to them.
That's awesome.
But so when you go to pitch to these sports teams, like, what are some of the objections or challenges they have, and how do you approach those?
That's a good question. I'm trying to think of one, because really the biggest objection we had is, who have you worked with in the United States? Because that's kind of who everyone follows. And now that we just had this NBA playoffs case study, the conversations have been phenomenal. We're now negotiating across a couple of the major leagues in North America. But if I had to answer your question, so the biggest thing is it's the digital shift within their business model. Okay, so their sales teams are used to selling assets that are more traditional, like, but even website banners, and here, I'll give you 3 tweets about your brand, right? And so for them, it's really an education process. Like, how can I get my team to be sophisticated enough to sell this type of experiential asset? And that's the leadership team is kind of aligned on there, but it's more about, you know, are we ready to take on this type of innovative mindset as an organization?
Okay, cool.
Thanks.
So have you started generating revenue yet, or is this pilot projects with some of the teams? All right.
Yeah, so as I mentioned, we hit our 6-figure revenue goal last year, and we were profitable on the books. Okay. Yeah, so we make money on every contract, and the unit economics of this business is extremely attractive. Yeah. So for our last event, it really varies. Anywhere between 3 and 12 cameras, and that's just a function of how long you would want your fans to wait in line. If there are more than one, there's more than one person per camera, then you would just get a message saying you're second in line. And actually, while you're second in line, you get to watch the person that's live on the camera, and live controlling it. So it's also kind of a fun experience while you wait. But the average queue that we see is about 6 people in line, so it's not too bad.
How do you actually control it? Because I'm wondering if they only have 30 seconds, yeah. It might take them 30 seconds to figure out what they're doing.
Yeah, we try to make it a really simple interface. Let me see if I have screenshots. Here we go. Yeah, so here's the quick interface. Are you sitting in a section, suite, number? Okay, go, find me now. And on the fourth screen, you see the dudes that it's like, okay, that's me. And then so then from there you swipe to pan, you pinch and like pinch to zoom, and then when you're ready, you just snap your photo, and then it beams back and it says share to get your high resolution. So they're incentivized to share. There's filters and, you know, all sorts of different ways that we can overlay the branding.
Providing the video infrastructure, or is it already built into the stadiums in the market you're after?
The radio infrastructure, sorry, what do you mean?
Video infrastructure. So the cameras and all the networking they're connected to.
Yeah, so I mean, we bring our camera systems inside to the stadiums, which they would pay the upfront cost for, and then we plug them through Ethernet, so that internet infrastructure is already set up so that we rely on their networking. We supply the cameras and the software that actually monitors all the cameras live during the game, gathers the analytics afterwards, et cetera. Cool. Thank you so much, guys.
Thank you so much. So we're setting up for our next road talk. So guys, the next road talk is a bit special. It's going to be provided by Pierre Saint-Arnaud from CGI, provider of Nethris Payroll Solutions. Pierre is the product manager at CGI, and he's been with them for the past, you know, for over 20 years. And today is a bit special. It's Pierre Saint-Arnaud's birthday. So together, let's sing him happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. My voice is ugly. Happy birthday to Pierre. Louder. Happy birthday, Pierre.
He'll be providing you with a gift of knowledge.
Yes, of course. Good morning, everyone. Yes, as this says, we're talking, we're discussing perils and the different risks related to that. And we're also going to touch a couple of other elements. So I know you're all super excited to hear about payroll. Don't stampede out of the room, please. The thing with payroll is that it's simply a must. Okay, so there's no way you're going to avoid it, whatever you try to do. So let's just make sure that we understand the issues, and we're not going into any deep technical details. Although if you have any very specific questions, I'm going to be happy to discuss that. My friend standing right there is Domenico. He's from National Bank. He's a payroll specialist. If there's something that I don't know, he will cover that. So let's get that thing on the road. First thing I want to say is that let's start at the beginning. And we're talking startup here, and you at one point you were all startups. So you had a great idea. You hopefully wrote a great business plan. You found financing, or you're looking for financing, like many people in this room. And some of you will get an address on the street, and then you're on. Okay, so you're selling services, you're selling product, whatever you want to do. You're very busy starting your business. Okay, just before we talk payroll, and what is coming there is not an exhaustive list, it's just a couple of reminder. Government expects things from you. You need to be aware that you will owe money to the government on a very regular basis, okay? Each dollar that you're gonna pay to your employee, part of that will also, there's a percentage that will need to be paid to government. I don't know how familiar you are with remittances. So this page here is, as I said, is not something that you need to take note of. It's something that it's very important that you don't forget. I mean, you will need to remit money. It's gonna be based on your payroll frequency. It's gonna be established based on your profile, and there's gonna be very specific delays that will need to be respected. And if you miss those, you're gonna see later that it can be very costly. Okay, so that's the first thing that you will need to deal with. Another aspect is, and by the way, yes, it says something about payroll frequency. There are laws that are regulating this, and it can be very tricky. We're in Ontario here in Quebec. Some people are tempted to pay their employees on a monthly basis. Well, depending on the type of employee you are, it can be illegal. It's that simple. So not everyone's aware of that. So the other aspect that I want to touch, and again, I am in no way your legal advisor this morning, so don't ask me to sign anything off for you. But the question of how you will pay yourself is a key issue. Okay, well, you want to pay you a salary, or you want to pay dividend? Well, just a quick reminder, a couple of notes. It's completely different, and being paid in form of a salary means that you're actually considered an employee, where if you're paid by dividend, you're considered a shareholder. I mean, there's a lot of technical issues, of legal issues related to this, but again, if you're a startup and you're not aware of that, think of it. And the thing is, there are good sides to both of these options, and it's not a matter of taste. It's not you that will decide in the morning, yeah, well, that's it, I think it's a good deal. It has to do with laws, and there's a lot of consideration that are legal, again. And the government has the right to say, well, for the last 6 months, 6 years, whatever, you paid yourself or considered yourself an employee, well, surprise, you were not. And when a decision like this is taken and it reverses something that you did, it means that all calculation needs to be redone. And it might bring a lot of money on the table, okay? So keep that in mind. And to be paid the salary, just to give you a couple of hints of how these decisions are made, you need to work, you know? So you're not just sitting home saying, yes, I'm a salaried employee. You need to produce actual work. I'm keeping it as light as possible and as simple, but that's it. On the other hand, if you decide to pay dividend, well, then you don't improvise that. It needs to be part of your chart. It needs to be well established in your company definition. Okay? That's all I have to say about this. If you have questions later, we have expertise regarding that, but I want to go on with other things. And the key is, don't take my word for it. Talk to your accountant, okay? The word accountant will come through a couple of times in this discussion. Your accountant will probably be a very good friend of yours. Your accountant should be a friend. Your lawyer might be a friend too. Okay, so these very important decisions need to be made with legal expertise. Okay, then you will say, is this thing working? Yeah. You're probably ready to hire. Okay, you know how things are set up. You're ready to go. Well, another big question is, will you hire contractual employees or will you actually hire employees? And at first, it's very tempting, and everyone knows that in the room. It's tempting to hire contractual. You don't want to create a link with an employee necessarily early in the process. But again, it's not a matter of taste. And there are general concepts that are important there. I'm just listing a few items. The documentation is exhaustive on the web if you go there. An employee has protections that a contractual does not have, basically. That's something to consider. Au Québec, c'est le code... what's it called? C'est le code du travail, okay? That regulates hours that are work, minimum salaries, blah, 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 where contractuals are not protected under the same bylaws, okay? Something else is, we were discussing earlier, a salaried employee is a fiscal burden on you. So all the aspect of remittances and so on that we already touched is different completely for an employee and a contractual. So it might be tempted to think, well, an employee is more expensive, let's hire only contractual. That I think is oversimplifying. A salaried employee is also based on law, I mean, because of his employee status, has some obligation toward you, where a contractual is basically his own employer, okay? And finally, a contractual is a self-employed, okay? And that's it. Again, you think very easy calculation, let's stick with contractual, they're much easier to manage and so on. Well, again, establishing the status, there are key words there, okay? One of them is control, because as an employer, basically you control what your employee is doing. Control their work schedule, control priorities, you control methods, where a contractual has much more independence. Tools and equipment, but very in a general sense, if you provide the different tools and whatever tools mean to your employee, to the actual person working, well, this employee is considered an employee, where a contractual will be responsible to buy, to manage, and to renew, and to maintain all his tools. This one is a pretty obvious one. As an employee in the morning, if you're too busy, well, you don't take the phone and hire someone to help you, okay? So subcontracting is something that, as an employee, you cannot do. And a contractual basically manages his own revenue, manages his own burden, workload, so it's possible to subcontract, okay? And these other aspects all have to do with what the financial link. You know, as an employee, you're not at risk. You're not necessarily at risk. You're not also responsible for profit. So, well, where, as we were saying earlier, a contractual basically is his own employer, his own business. Again, I was saying that the government is looking very closely at these, and recently, I think, more closely than ever, okay? So if they go to your office and they find that one of your contractual has only you as a client, and it's often considered a key element, if the employee, if this person only works for you as a contractual, well, they might say, well, this employee is not a contractual, it's an employee. What do you have to do then? All the money that you paid is considered salary. Then you need to calculate government remittances and all that, and they're all due. Again, big money. So you're an expert in all this. You finally hire someone, okay? And I say the trouble begins. In fact, it's not really trouble. It's more responsibilities. And you will find out first pay week that the payroll process does not stop with printing a check. Okay, this list there is pretty long. I don't want to look at all of these, and it's not even a complete list. Anyone that has employee in this room is aware of all that. Sorry, thank you. So these are all fun things that you need to become expert at if you want to manage your own payroll. They're all regulated by laws, by legal regulations. They all have a tendency to change. When there's an election, when there's a budget change, when whatever happens, all these calculations that are already tricky can need to be updated. So what can you do with this, basically? Well, which takes us to our main subject, the different risk level linked to payroll management. First one has to do with compliance. I just said that all these regulations are changing. I mean, if you're managing by yourself all the payroll calculations, what can you do? I mean, how can you stay aware of all these changes and make sure that they apply on the right effective date and so on? I mean, different work code, different tables are really complex. They're everywhere. Think statutory holidays. Statutory holidays are not calculated the same way in the province of Quebec that they are in Ontario or in Manitoba. Absolutely not. Statutory holidays are not calculated the same way if you're a full-time employee, a part-time employee, an employee paid by commission. You know, all things to that need to be considered. WSIB or CSST in Quebec is money that you owe the government that needs to be calculated. And that small box there that looks a little bit awkward is there to remind you that not only do you need to manage payroll information, you need to archive this based on legislation. So some reports need to be available and kept for 2 years. Some are you need to maintain for 7 years. So do you have all the infrastructure to manage all this? Because if the government rings at your door, not the good news. When an employee leaves, again, I don't know if you ever had to deal with this, but the ROE is not the simplest thing to do. And since you're not firing employee every day, you're never gonna be a specialist in producing ROE, hopefully. And these calculations of insurable weeks, insurable amounts, very, very tricky, okay? I think I got the point there. If you look at all these, the question is payroll your expertise? Do you want to spend your days wondering about your payroll calculation, or you want to sell bread or software or services and focus on expanding your actual business? Second level of risk is a pretty obvious one. It's in the paper every single day. It has to do with privacy. So as soon as you hire your first employee, you become the owner of confidential data, okay? think addresses, think banking information, think SIN number. And the fun thing is that you're required by law to protect this information. Okay, so you are responsible to protect the confidentiality of your employees. And I don't need to look very far. I mean, you're aware that Netris is part of CGI Group. CGI is a fairly large IT company. If I tell you that we have thousands of attacks every day on our networks, would you be surprised? Well, don't be, okay? Because we're actually dealing with thousands of attacks on our networks. And we sleep at night very well, and I don't know if I would sleep that well if everything that I have in my company was sitting on one single computer somewhere, no connected to a half-safe Wi-Fi network, okay? So this is very, very important. It has a lot to do with the quality of your infrastructure where your system are hosted. This, I just mentioned, it's identity theft, okay? The third risk has to do with business risk. Everyone knows what a recovery plan is, okay? As soon as you have a business, you need some kind of recovery plan. I mean, imagine that I'm a printer, I'm a big printing shop. Well, I must have a second machine ready to replace my first machine if something breaks down. I mean, it's obvious, everyone knows that. But and by the way, I just added that thing about the Canadian Payroll Association because they put a lot of emphasis on that. Make sure that your recovery plan covers everything. I mean, you wake up in the morning, you go to your office, the server's not there. How quickly can you fall back on your feet? Have the equipment, have the software ready to operate again and run your payroll. Your data, of course, are they safe? And I'm talking to people that are mostly IT in this room, but I would still be curious to go and take a look at your backup plan, okay? Is your data safe? Are you backing that up on a regular basis? Are the backup outside of your building and blah, blah, blah? Okay, think infrastructure again. And something that people are always neglecting, if you have one person in charge of your payroll in your company and this person leaves, well, next week, who's gonna run your payroll, okay? Are you suddenly able to hire that quickly? Does everyone knows your system? Probably not. So this is why we're gonna get where we're going now with alternatives. The final risk, and it's one that speaks fairly loudly, has to do with financial risk. I already explained that you owe the government money, you owe the government reports. They expect that at specific dates, and they are absolutely zero, they have zero tolerance. Okay, so if you look at only for federal government, this is something that are actual figures. So just imagine whatever the amount of your remittances that are due is, well, apply this percentage and you're gonna see how bad it can be. I mean, I don't need to invent example. At a recent trade show, a guy was telling me, the government sent me a letter, I have a report that was 2 months late. Well, 2 months late, and they sent him something like a $900 fine for that, okay? Doesn't sound like much, but for the size of the company that this guy had, $900 was probably covering for his payroll services for 2 years, you know, because it was a very, very small company. So it's very significant. So don't bother, don't take the risk, okay? In summary, okay, those different risks are fairly simple. Complex laws that need to be kept updated, rules and regulation that needs to be tracked. Privacy, confidential data that you need to keep protected. Your business plan that should cover payroll and that should even cover the resources that are taking care of payroll. And finally, the money that you don't want to put on the table for nothing. So if it's that risky, there's still a good side to it. I mean, I don't need to say that when your employees are paid correct amount on time, it's a very important aspect of their satisfaction. That's not the only one. I mean, we all read the same HR documents, quality, environment, colleagues, blah, 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 but stop paying your employees and they're gonna forget that they have a window very quickly, you know. So that's very important, and which brings again the same question. Is payroll processing your field of expertise. Obviously not, how can you process payroll? Well, if you're really a big risk taker, you might want to handle your payroll with the Excel spreadsheet, okay? But do I need to explain that it's almost impossible to manage those calculations? How will you protect your data? You're gonna have all the banking charges there and you're gonna be responsible for the government remittances. A second alternative that is very, and take my word, very popular has to do with your accountant. I already said your accountant is your friend, so that's good. I have nothing bad to say against accountant, especially since there's a bunch of them in the room. The thing is, they're specialists in accounting. They're not necessarily payroll specialists, and they're not always that excited about payroll processing. Take my word, we deal with a lot of them. How much will they charge you for that? You'll still be responsible for your banking charges. You're still responsible for your government remittances, and is your data really safe? Another very popular alternative, and again, I'll say nothing against accounting software because one of our good friends right here in the next room is QuickBooks, and they're very, very good and they're essential. But again, their specialty is accounting. So payroll is not their specialty. You might still have to pay for your banking charges. You might have to be responsible for your remittances and so on. Well, which takes us basically to the last alternative, which is why not use a payroll outsourcing? And again, I already said in the intro, not to scare you, that no, a payroll service does not only deal with large companies. Of course, the super large corporations are using payroll services, but everyone that has an employee is eligible, if I can say. Why? Well, the first reason would be to save time. Based on the independent survey, this shows what was identified as the most time-consuming task for payroll person. And it's very simple to understand. It's payroll entry, it's writing the journal entry, managing time banks, and looking for legal information. If you wonder what the last one means, it's the hours that you spend on the phone trying to reach someone at the federal government to explain how to create your ROE or whatever. Well, all this is taken care of by your payroll provider. Second one has to do with reduced cost. Because of course, if you don't pay fines, well, you're saving money. When you consider the price of a payroll service, it covers banking charges, it covers the government remittances. So again, it's pretty obvious. Third one has to do with payroll being a complex process. No one will pretend that it's an easy thing. So payroll is complicated. A payroll service have a lot of specialists that are there to follow the legislation. They're there to stay on top of everything that is changing on a daily basis, and they're also there to answer all your questions. So instead of waiting in line to talk to someone in the government, your payroll provider is there to provide the expertise. Again, the same survey said that the complexity is also important, so end of year processing, looking for legal information, managing time banks, records of employment are the key item identified by paymasters. We're almost done. The fourth reason is to reduce risk, and this one, I mean, was the main subject that I just covered. Think of all the different level of risk that we discuss. A payroll service provider will offer you a strong infrastructure, secure infrastructure, data protection, data backup, everything that needs to control your access in respect of legislation will be covered by this. And finally, and one of the key reasons why people are most of the time happy with payroll services is that there's always someone to answer your phone call. And it's someone that, as opposed to someone at government, it's someone that has access to your actual company record. So they know exactly what you're talking about. They know your configuration, they know your figures, they know everything. Just a quick reminder, we are NetRisk payroll provider. Who in this room is familiar with NetRisk brand? Who has heard? I need to see at least one hand from that guy in front. Okay, so is actually the only one familiar with Netress, okay? Which means that we're probably rotten at branding our own product. The thing is that we're not a new player at all. We've been in the business forever, okay? Over 40 years of experience, not under the name Netress, that's why it's a fairly new name. We're dealing with over 13,000 clients that are representing close to 400,000 employees paid across Canada. And again, keep in mind that 87% of our clients have less than 50 employees, 80%. So yes, we are dealing with very small businesses. I cannot tell you how many of our clients have one employee, okay? It does make sense, okay? So that's very important to remember. And who's familiar with the name CGI? Yeah, you know, more people. Well, Netress is the brand name of the payroll services center of CGI. Okay, so it's a division, it's a business division of CGI. CGI being, you know, 70,000 employees worldwide, very well known in the IT infrastructure and so on, which guarantees you probably the best infrastructure. Well, for me, that covers it. If you have any question, don't be afraid. I mean, it's really specific. You can come outside of the room and talk to us. Domenico really wants to talk to people. If you have something that is of general interest, we have a few seconds. Feel free to ask. Was that all those things you were aware of? You knew all that, and you're still not convinced that you need someone to process your payroll? If that's all for me, it's thank you. Any question? Yeah, one, sir. Okay. Well, it's a very, very precise question. I'm going, well, Domenico, how about you handle this one? Is this on?
Hello? No. I could more or less ballpark it for you, but at the end of the day, it's on a base cost and a per employee cost. So, you know, I could give you a ballpark estimate, say it's about, our base cost is around $20, and if you have two employees, about $1.50 each. So you're looking for payroll processing, about $23 for two employees, and then it works to scale that way. All right? No, that's per pay period. So if you pay twice a month, then that would be twice a month.
So
but within those costs, obviously, what's going on there is that all your transactional costs, that you'd normally be paying either for your checks or transactions at the bank, that's all included in the pricing as well, okay? And as Pierre mentioned, you know, we'll process everything gross to net. We do your direct deposits, handle all your remittances, your T4s, et cetera. So there's a lot of fixed costs.
Unlimited support, of course.
Yes,
and because you're
support.
In this room, we yeah. waive the implementation fees, so we're not trying to make money with implementing payroll.
That's right. And some of the other, you know, hidden costs that Pierre talked about, you know, there are. If you are consulting with somebody or if you are asking for technical support, you are paying for other costs. Whereas with us, it's all part of, you know, the costs that I stated. All right. Any other questions? No? Okay.
Well, I really appreciate that you stayed in the room for a payroll speech. It's not always easy. We made sure that the door was almost impossible to reach, so.
Yeah.
So thank you. So if you want to escape before the next presentation, you have a very small window.
And as Pierre mentioned, we're next door. If you were too shy to ask us questions in here, by all means, stop by and see us, okay? Thanks for your time.
All right, thank you, Pierre. All right, so we have our next pitching company up. And just to let you know, All this is being live streamed, and it's also going to be put on YouTube so you can watch it afterwards. So that's one of the reasons I actually wanting to make sure you guys have the microphone so that everyone can hear it, you know, once it's taped. So, and if there's anything along the way that you do not want taped, you know, just let us know, and we'll, you know, we'll take it. Obviously, if it's a pitch or if there's some kind of comment, we'll just make sure to remove that. So,
all right.
Our next pitch.
All right, up next, SwiftPad, and he's right outside actually, so I'll get it. All right.
Interesting how it's flickering a bit, eh?
That's okay, so 5 minutes pitch, 5 minutes Q&A. And you guys want to do them?
Check, check.
Hello?
Hi, I'm Maxim.
My name is Amir.
And we are SwiftPad. We build products for pharmacies. So the problem with the current practice, do we have a clicker? Oh. So the problem with the current practice of pharmacy is that the entire process relies on paper and happens over the phone. So you go to the doctor's office, you get a paper prescription. You have two options, fax it or drop it off. Either way, both you and your doctor, both you and your doctor lose visibility of the prescription, and you have no idea when it will be ready for pickup. The process is also problematic for the pharmacist because process is also problematic for the pharmacist because they have to deal with a lot of legacy software and they deal with an incredible amount of paperwork. So at the end of the entire process, nobody has an easily accessible record of your current refills and past medication. And the pharmacist also often has to make callbacks to the doctors to figure out your medical history. So we spend about $30 billion in Canada on drug expenditure, which represents about 15.4% of the total health expenditure market. There are almost 10,000 pharmacies in Canada, with about half of them located in Ontario. To put this in terms of prescriptions, there are 450 million prescribed every year. The average independent pharmacy does about 20,000 prescriptions a year, and the average retail chain does about 200,000. For our purposes, we divided the demographic into three user personas. Meet Annie, who's over 65. She has a number of chronic conditions, which she takes 4 to 5 daily medications for. Then we have Austin, 35 to 65, who has a single chronic condition and takes 1 daily medication. Finally, we have Kim, who's generally healthy, and she takes at most 7 to 8 medications per year. So how do we solve the problems I described before in our unique Canadian market for these three user personas?
Our solution is SwiftPad. SwiftPad is an electronic prescription management system that streamlines the entire workflow and processes for both patients and pharmacies. Patients at the doctor's office can add a prescription on their mobile phone, choose a pharmacy, and receive real-time updates on their prescription order. When the order is ready, they'll receive a text notification that it's ready for pickup. Lastly, we also facilitate the order process for pharmacists by providing instant access to patient information, insurance, health history, and personal information. Patients are also able to manage and add prescription refills in just a few taps. Our pharmacy solution is a cloud-based management solution, which seamlessly integrates and facilitates the existing processes in place at the pharmacy. The features in place are real-time updates on prescription order, instant access to digital prescriptions, direct end-to-end communication with the patient, and instant access to patient information. Our product has an advantage in place that seamlessly integrates. With SwiftPad in place, we've seen a shift towards more patient-focused services, where pharmacists are able to actually provide more counseling and medication management therapy for patients. With SwiftPad in place, we've seen about a 30% more operational efficiency in pharmacies and about 40% less callbacks between the patient and the pharmacy.
So one of our key initiatives is the development and integration of a number of vertical microservices. So we're currently working with existing EMR providers to fully integrate electronic prescribing and complete the end-to-end process between the doctor, the user, and the pharmacy. Right now we're partnered with one such provider, and we hope to launch in June. Another one of our products is Septara. It's a bot for discrete medication reminders with intelligent tracking all through Facebook Messenger. She understands plain English, so you can message her just like you would another person. So with Septara, we have three goals. The first one is bolstering the SwiftPad brand. The second is acting as a growth funnel for our core product. And the third is fix it. All right. And yeah, sure. So
three
growth. Yeah. All right, we'll just go on. Behind the scenes, we have Alexis, which is collects data, unstructured data from a variety of sources, applies transformations as needed, and houses safely for the data research. So with this, we'll be able to apply to a number of different functions such as farm R&D, cross-data analysis, and prescription monitoring. And finally, in marketing, we have a number of B2B opportunities. So we're partnering with different companies and providing discounted fees and benefits in exchange for critical mass of users.
One of our key initiatives within our company is working on strategic partnerships with existing companies in place. So we're currently based out of the IBM innovation space. What's going on?
I don't know. All right.
We're currently based out of the IBM innovation space, working with IBM to secure a partnership and working with the clients that IBM already has. So we're exploring on running a pilot program with Shoppers and Rexall within the next few months. One of the key initiatives is also leveraging opportunities in integrating with digital health tools and wearables to improve patient service and build brand loyalty. And lastly, introducing new servants and engagement tools to increase the patient pharmacy engagement within that 15 to 30 minutes of the wasted engagement time. Our competitive landscape is divided into three sectors. We have electronic health records like ZapRx, Relay Health. We have mail order pharmacies like PillPack and ScriptDash. We have on-demand services like Pilly and PopRx. However, SwiftPad is an integration of all three landmarks in one. Our revenue model for SwiftPad for the pharmacies is broken down to three tiers that you can see right here, based on prescription frequencies on an annual prescription basis. We also, for the retail pharmacies, we provide an enterprise solution, which is enterprise pricing itself. Right now, pharmacies pay $5,000 a year just for one license on a computer. Ours is a fraction of that cost. Our timeline and roadmap in May is we have currently three pharmacies and one partnership with an employer. And we released our artificial intelligence bot. June, we're launching our Oscar integration and three employee partnerships and a new product release. And in July, we'll be almost at 10,000 in MRR, new product release, and 15 pharmacies in total. Our team is unique in some sense. We've all been friends since being 14 years old, all from the University of Toronto, except one. We have experience from working at Wattpad, HR.com, AMD. We won the last Funnico Roadshow. You know, we work out of the IBM Global Entrepreneur Program at the space at 1 in 5 Spadina. And our advisory board is unique in some sense. Jonathan Francis helps us with operation efficiency from Millie Daly, the guy acquired last year. CCO and VP of Purdue Pharma, who serves as our pharmaceutical expertise. And Faisal Abed, who's an early employee at Kobo and a Google developer expert who helps us on the tech side. Thank you for your time. If you have any questions, you can answer it.
Thanks. Could you go back to the slide that you said something about 30% or 40% operational efficiency? So improved pharmacy operational efficiency, 30% seems like a really big number. Is that from a case study? I mean, can you kind of break that down and explain what that really means in terms of maybe dollars or how you got to that?
Right. So the parameters that we used for this sort of data was to look at the average time spent with the patient itself, and how many new patients were given introduced in some sense to the new pharmacy. So, you know, in a day, they allocate about, let's say, to 100 prescriptions or 100 patients in some sense at a pharmacy. We saw about 30% increase in more patients and prescriptions being being dispensed at the pharmacy itself after the introduction of SwiftPad.
That was a great pitch. So my one question is, you seem pretty young. Like, how did you get into this? Do you have like a emotional, personal connection to pharmaceuticals?
You actually remind me, I forgot to say that in my pitch. Yeah, so I grew up in a family of all pharmaceutical execs and pharmacists. I work in a pharmacy, and I've come from a health sciences background, pharmacology. So I experienced this pain point both behind the counter and over, and I knew that this was a problem that needed to be fixed. Yeah, I should have mentioned that. Any other questions? Revenue timeline.
How many pharmacies are you working with right now?
Currently, we have three pharmacies. They're based on patient demand, so they're covering the downtown core and other areas within the city itself. Yeah. The problem isn't about bringing pharmacies on board, but it's more towards catering the patients itself. So we really do it based on the patients in the area. They can actually request a pharmacy, and we'll go out and bring the pharmacy on board.
Okay.
And the turnaround for the bringing pharmacies, like the sales cycle is about like 5 to 6 days.
Since many parties involved in your whole operation, which party is who is your customer, real customer, and where's the revenue comes from?
Who is our real customer?
Yeah.
So our real customer are the pharmacies. So for the independents, we offer a subscription-based service based on the tiers that they fall into. As for enterprise, so like retail pharmacies and pharmaceutical companies, we charge on a case-by-case basis. That really depends. So we're running a pilot in the next 2 months. Putting it together, so we'll have a better understanding by then. But the pharmacies are the customers. Patients do not pay. Healthcare is free. Oh yeah, we marched in. Do you want to talk about the bot? What the bot does? Yeah, because you didn't get a chance to talk about it.
I actually want to just expand on this. Because we're running out of time. So right now, with IEEE is a confirmed partnership. So we thought it's a great place to start with our B2B opportunities because, you know, it's a technology-driven crowd. The average age is around 40 to 50, so it hits our key demographic. And right now, we're still in talks with Elite Daily and Mega Merch, but we expect these to be some of our key user acquisition channels. Thanks.
So guys, we are just fixing the projector. While we do that, I'd like to introduce our next speaker, Randy Jones, who's the Senior Director of Technology Innovation at Canary. Randy works with the Government of Canada to deliver digital infrastructure that supports research, education, small business growth, and Canada's digital economy. So give him a warm welcome, round of applause. Man, I always trip out on this. Thank you. The audience.
Good morning. Thank you, Lana. I grew up in the disco era. I'm kind of enjoying this flashing. I don't know how many else, but I won't dance. That wouldn't be pretty, especially on YouTube. It would give my kids even more reason to make fun of me. So I'm from Canary. Canary is a not-for-profit company. We're based in Ottawa. We're funded by Industry, Science, and Economic Development Canada, and we support research, education, and private sector innovation across Canada, and we have five different programs through which we accomplish that. One is a network that runs across the nation, and it connects most universities and colleges in the country, so it's used for research or transfer of data. We have a program that is a federated single sign-on service as well as a roaming Wi-Fi service. We fund research software with the goal of ensuring that research grants go towards the research and not developing single-use software. We also run a research Data Canada, which is a new program started late in 2015, and its goal is to ensure that the product of research, which is usually data sets, is getting exploited to the benefit of the country. And last not least, we run a cloud service called DARE, the Digital Accelerator for Innovation and Research, and I'll be talking about that today and topics that are general to the cloud. So, quick question, how many people in the room are either a software developer, identify as a software developer, or is an entrepreneur who's working with a team of software developers? Okay, great, about half. So this talk is generally targeted towards that audience, but there's also some basic cloud information that we hope can educate those that maybe are new to cloud and cloud concepts. So what's going on in Canada? Well, today in Canada, our economy is shifting from a resource-based economy where we pull stuff out of the ground, we cut down trees, and we harvest animals, unfortunate animals, and it's shifting towards the internet and, in particular, data collection and processing. And this is spawning a whole new era of innovation where, through exploiting of data, we're able to optimize products, company processes, company structures, gain new insights in how markets work and businesses work. And you know, the more of these I go to and the more entrepreneurs that I speak to, the more I'm seeing that a key element of their solution is collecting and processing data. It's very powerful to, you know, gather data from some area, to join it with other data, to analyze it, and then form predictions. And as an example, taking one data set like point of sale terminal information, joining it with weather, which is a very predictable set of information, and using that to try and predict sales or to tweak offers to a given market. So it's very powerful. And you know, data is just growing like crazy. Cisco, which runs a cloud report annually, is forecasting that by 2019 there'll be 180 petabytes of data collected daily from a city of 1 million people. So that's a lot of data, and I like to think there's gold in that data. It's just as software people, we need to sort of go into that data and mine it. You got that? All right. Ask the lady two seats down about that slide. I think she's the author of that. So you can, yeah. I'm just the talking head here today. All right, thank you. So, and companies that exploit data are becoming and are household names. You know, the names up here, Facebook, Google, Amazon, we all know about them, and companies that exploit data tend to have four times the revenue per employee than those that do not. So it's a great opportunity, and if we're not paying attention to it, our competitors are, so we need to really do that. So what are some of the technology trends that are part of this whole data revolution? One is very low cost, highly scalable storage. So today you can get storage from Amazon in their Elastic Block service for about 3 cents a gigabyte per month. So that's very low cost and about a tenth of what you would pay for the equivalent on-premise storage. And they also have other services like Glacier, which is for long-time storage, long-term archival and storage, which is 1 cent a gigabyte per month. So this is very compelling. So storage is one, networking is the other. So we have very high capacity, low latency access from a broad set of devices, phones, tablets, laptops. And then we have applications that contextualize our personal and business lives so that we can use that data to get things done. And underpinning all of this is cloud technology. So what is cloud technology? So this is where, what can cloud do for your business? Well, generally, it'll allow you to get to market sooner than approaches where you might try to build the infrastructure yourself. And it'll allow you to reach a global market because it's in the cloud. You can access it from anywhere. So it allows you to scale up rapidly and much faster than if you were building your own infrastructure. And at a couple of these talks, I've talked about a prior employer of mine, about 10 years ago, we were building a authentication authorization system for tier one wireless data providers. And I estimated about 60 to 70% of the R&D budget we spent there was really just on building boring stuff like data synchronization between databases. And you know, today with the cloud, you really don't need to do that. You can you can rent other people's infrastructure, and it allows you to focus on your business. So please do not try to build your own infrastructure unless you have some very specific need to do that. So what is the cloud? The cloud is on-demand access to compute, storage, and network resources. It allows you to spin up these resources when you need them and spin them down when you don't. And you only pay for what you use. It's typically charged out at an hourly rate. So the cloud providers take on the risk of building out and capitalizing their infrastructure, and you just rent it. You don't have to put that money up front, and you can otherwise use that money to build your business. There are three main compute models in cloud. And I'll use a house analogy just to summarize what those are. So infrastructure as a service, if you're building a house, is like the foundation. It's a set of machines with a virtualization layer, but it's not a house. If you needed to build a software application, much like a house, you need to build on that foundation. You need to hire developers. It takes a longer period of time than other models. The next model is platform as a service. So platform as a service builds on top of infrastructure as a service by providing reusable software services. For example, database as a service, load balancer as a service, asynchronous messaging as a service. Amazon, as an example, has about 40 such services, and they allow you to build your application faster. So back to the house analogy, this is analogous to using prefabricated components to build your house. You'll get it done sooner, but you may pay a little more for it. And finally, there's software as a service. So if you wanted a house and you don't want to buy a house, you can just rent a house. And software as a service is the same thing. And there are many examples of that. You saw Netris talk earlier, and QuickBooks Online. These are both great examples of SaaS. So why do we care about the compute models in cloud computing? Well, one reason is the approach you take to building your application will affect your time to market. If you're using platform services, you'll be able to build your application sooner because there's more reuse of existing services. You don't have to build all that infrastructure. Conversely, if you're concerned about cost, platform services are going to cost you more once you've got your application built and it's deployed in production, because almost all the platform services that you may use from a cloud provider have a pay-for-use fee with them. And even if they're free, what they'll do is they'll use infrastructure services like more compute instances or more bandwidth or more storage, and you'll be paying for that. So depends on what your interest is, time to market or keeping your costs lower once you get into production, which of these services you would choose. And finally, there's vendor lock-in. So early on in most software companies, you're probably not so concerned about vendor lock-in, but later on, you may wish to, you know, maybe switch vendors for cost or other reasons. So with platform services, the more platform services you use, the more you will be locked into a given vendor, because platform services are not standardized across the various commercial cloud providers. Additionally, when we talk about cloud services, there's something I call the cloud trap. And the cloud trap occurs because with cloud services, to scale up, you need to horizontally add compute instances to handle the load on your application. That's great. If you've got a lot of customers or subscribers using your service, you scale up. But as you scale up, you pay more fees because you're using more resources. So you need automation to scale down. Automation code uses the application program interfaces on each cloud provider. And it's a non-trivial investment in automation to be able to scale up or scale down. You need to write automation code and treat it very much like you would your product development, because when you write this code to use an API, the APIs across cloud vendors are not standardized. They're all, if not entirely unique, there's very little reuse amongst them. So your investment in automation, if it is not structured correctly with a layer of abstraction so that you can swap out one cloud provider for another, could be stranded. So it's a bit of a trap. Without automation, you're probably not going to be able to scale down to save money. With automation, the more you invest in automation, you risk being locked into the vendor unless you architect your software correctly. So is it possible to avoid vendor lock-in? My opinion is it's not. You will be locked into the cloud provider you select. That's not a bad thing, but try to minimize the amount of lock-in. For example, do not use every platform service that's available. Use only the ones you need. Because let's say you have a student working on your project, and the student decides, hey, I could save 3 days of work by using this cool platform service. What's a student's time worth during 3 days of student time? It's probably not worth a lot in the larger scheme of your business. However, that decision that the student makes may cost you thousands of dollars a month later when your application is scaled up and running in production. You have to control how platform services are introduced into your solution. So avoiding vendor lock-in. One, minimize the amount of platform services that you use. Two, make sure that you're using compatible technologies for transferring your assets between clouds. So standard image formats, Docker containers are a very powerful way of isolating your code from a specific vendor. Invest in automation to move your assets from cloud to cloud and your data from cloud to cloud. Profile the resource consumption of your application under load so that as you scale up in production, you will understand your cost base. It's important to understand your cost base because if you don't, it's hard to get a handle on your margin. And track market conditions because we believe the market is changing rapidly. And in Canada in particular, in the last year and a half or 2 years, there's been a number of small commercial cloud providers emerge. Oro, as example, in BC is an OpenStack provider. They've got an excellent product, Cloud A in the East Coast area. SoftLayer or IBM will be speaking later. They've got a great product. And there's a number of small ones, but what has been missing prior than a couple years ago was the big cloud service providers putting their data centers in Canada and guaranteeing data sovereignty. So almost a year ago, Microsoft announced two data centers in Canada. Those data centers are now built up and running, and Microsoft is pursuing the large verticals with that right now. I don't believe those data centers are available to the public yet, but it will not be long. DigitalOcean is a cost leader in the US. You can buy an instance from DigitalOcean for $5 a month, which is very low cost, and they are now available and running out of Toronto. And last and not least at all is Amazon. So Amazon in January announced that they were building out a data center in the Montreal area. It's in progress. We don't have a date for when it'll be online, but this will exert additional pressure within the Canadian market on prices. And speaking of prices, we track prices in Canada across a number of service providers, and right now, it costs about $57 a month to lease a compute instance. So that's an average number. And a compute instance would be a virtual server with one CPU core, 2 gigs of RAM, you know, roughly 20 gigabyte of block storage, and less than 5 terabytes of data transfer. With all this change in the market, we do believe that prices will be coming down. And from a technology ingredient perspective in cloud computing. We expect it'll come down into the range that traditional web hosting is, so less than $10 a month. And it was interesting, I had the benefit of spending 2 days with an Amazon solution architect about a month ago, and he was talking about the cost of their service. And I was asking him about pricing, and he said, you know what, we've changed our price 41 times, and every single time it's been down. And we don't have an official policy that says it's going to go down, but you can probably spot a trend there. So I do believe that pricing will continue to go down. And this is important when you're developing your application, because you know, you don't want to be stuck on a price laggard, because your competitors will move to the best price to the extent that they can, and keeping your costs low will influence your margins and your business success. All right, so shifting gears, I'm going to talk about the Canary infrastructure as a service known as DARE. So DARE stands for Digital Accelerator for Innovation and Research. It was designed to help early stage companies in Canada sort of get going. It's a very risk-free cloud where you can learn how to build your application without exposing yourself to any real costs. To use our cloud, the eligibility requirements are very low. You have to be based in Canada, and you have to have less than 500 employees. And what we found with users of our cloud is that most of them, about 85%, are less than 10 employees. So it's really well suited to early stage startups that need some help. So why would you use our cloud? Well, first of all, it has equivalent functionality to most infrastructure as a service. So for example, anyone who's used Rackspace would find our cloud very similar in that we use the same cloud management system known as OpenStack. The cloud is absolutely free. You'll never pay a cent on our cloud unless you ask for more resources than you get with the free quota, and I'll talk about that in a minute. This is different than other commercial cloud providers. So if you're using a free entitlement out of a commercial cloud provider, usually you'll get one compute instance running continuously for a month. And if you spawn up a second one, you will pay for that. And if you exceed certain usage limits on that free surface, you will pay for that as well. In our cloud, you'll never pay for anything. It runs across our Canary backbone network, and it's accessible from the public network. We have a data center in Edmonton and a data center in Sherbrooke, Quebec, so you can test geographic redundancy if availability is something you're interested in your solution. And we've had almost 700 early stage startups come through our program to date. Most of them say they like to use our cloud because it's totally risk-free from a cost perspective. It has equivalent performance to a commercial cloud, and they can control exactly how they use it and sort out some of those pesky issues early in your product development, like how you're going to actually architect it, how you're going to scale it. You can use our cloud for those things. And we have a series of case studies on our website at canary.ca/cloud/case studies, where you can read how some companies are using it. Yes? The question was, how long can you use the cloud? I'll touch on that in a moment. So what do you get with this cloud? So free for a year. You can access our cloud for development, test, and early commercialization purposes. What you get with the free usage is a quota. And the quota is comprised of a maximum of 4 servers, 4 virtual CPUs, 8 gigs of RAM, four volumes with a total of 80 gigabytes of block storage and 200 gigabytes of object storage. Object storage is what you would put rich media on, like videos, pictures, audio, just blobs. We provide the operating system images with this, so we have two variants of Linux, there's CentOS as well as Ubuntu, and we also provide and pay for the Windows licenses, Windows Server 2008 as well as 2012. So we maintain those images. You can also upload your own images if you would like. There's always unlimited data transfer in and out because we use the Canary network and its peering arrangements into the public internet. We don't pay additional fees for bandwidth or data transfer, and neither will the users of our service. We provide support during business hours by email. So this is one way that we differ from a commercial cloud provider. Commercial cloud providers will provide usually a 24/7 service level arrangement or agreement with you. In our cloud, because we're not intended for production use, we do not provide SLAs. If you send us an email during business hours, we'll usually respond and help you out within an hour or two. But if you were to send us an email at 3 a.m. on a Saturday morning, well, you might not hear from us until Saturday. Usually you'll hear from us on the Sunday, but we don't guarantee it. And I'm also very pleased to announce that based on some of our user feedback, a lot of people were interested in getting access to graphic processor units. Before the end of June, we'll be making those available in our production cloud. So these are very handy if you're developing a gaming application or visualization, graphic editing, anything like that. By the way, I often get asked what happens at the end of a year. Right. I often get asked that. I'll come back to it. There's a question. Here's the call to action. So how would you sign up for this? It's very simple. You simply go to our website. You go to canary.ca/cloud. There's a button there that says apply to DARE. Click that button. You'll go to a form. We just need to know a little bit about your intended use. We need some contact information, why you want to use the cloud, and a little information about how big your business is. Like I say, you need to have less than 500 employees, which wouldn't that be a great problem to have? I have more than 500 employees and I can't use a free cloud. We'll process your application usually within a business day and get back to you. You'll get an email with your access credentials, and you'll be able to be up and running within minutes and start your development. So some of these questions, what happens after a year? Well, our fondest hope is that after a year, you've really proven that you've got a winning solution and you've moved into market, you have revenue, and you can migrate to a commercial cloud and start to use and pay for that service. If that's not the case, if it takes longer to build your business, you can apply for a second year of use. If we have capacity and you're still eligible, we'll grant you a second year of use. And that raises a question, how do you migrate in and out of our cloud? Well, cloud technology is based on a number of standard components. This question for software developers is usually a matter of daily consideration. You simply take a snapshot of a running server. You get what's known as an image. You can transfer that image out of one cloud. If necessary, convert it to a different format and then upload it to another cloud and then instantiate a new server image there, or server instance, I should say. There's also data transfer. So if you have data sets in one cloud, you need to transfer them to another. There's a number of utilities that make that relatively painless to do. I mentioned that we don't allow production use on our network, and there's a question, what is production use? So one thing that's clear, if you have 1 million subscribers and you're monetizing those subscribers, that would be production use. Don't do that in our cloud. We would like you to keep that cloud, our cloud, free for early stage startups. However, that doesn't mean you can't use our cloud if you're doing early trials. So these can be paid trials. You're at that stage where you're engaging your early customers, proving your solution works. That's fine in our cloud. It's also fine if you are running in production and you want to use our cloud for supporting activities like build servers, development, or other sustaining development. That's okay. I mentioned we provide support during business hours via email. And what if the free quota isn't enough? So I went through what the quota was. It's 4 instances with some resources. If that's not enough, you can send us an email and we'll sell you additional resources for a nominal fee. As an example, the free quota can be doubled for $400 a year, which in a commercial cloud would cost you at current prices around $2,500 to $3,000. So we're, as I say, Canary is a not-for-profit. We're not trying to make money off this. What we're trying to do is help startups in the best way we can and to keep it fair to all the startups across Canada. So we're happy to help you with more resources, but we do need a little bit of fees for when you go above our free quota. And that's the end of my talk. Are there any other questions that I can answer? Yes. A 100 times the free quota? I would say we probably cannot help you with that. Yeah, we have a limited cloud, and you know that's an extraordinary amount of resources. Any cloud provider, I think, would be challenged to provide that free to you. So we may be able to help you in other ways, but that sort of number is, you know, quite extreme. Yes. Yeah, so the question is the GPU offering a separate product or not? And the answer is the GPU ability to access the graphic processor units is built into our standard offering. The way you would select it is simply by selecting what's known as a special flavor, which defines the resource profile for the compute instance. Yeah. Yes. The question is there any news on whether Google's cloud is coming to Canada? And I'm afraid I don't know. I'm blind to that. It's a good question, though, because recently I understand Google is, you know, they have awesome technology and they've realized that maybe they're not exploiting it as much as some of the other big cloud providers. So I understand that's going to pick up, but I don't have any information there. Yes, at the back. Yeah, if you've built up your, sorry, the question is, if I built my solution in the Canary Cloud, how do I get it out and transferred into another service provider? A, you need to plan for that in advance, but mechanically speaking, you're right. The way you would do that is if you've built up your compute instance in our cloud, you would take a snapshot of that and download it out of our cloud and upload it into another. But if you're not currently using container technology, I would strongly encourage you to explore that because containers really provide a level of independence beyond just virtualization. And I think we've used all our time. Do I have one more? One last question. Yeah, so I think the question you're asking, if I could summarize it, is how do we provide isolation between tenants and the cloud? Yeah, so we use pretty much the same method that any cloud provider does. You get scheduled, your workloads get scheduled onto a physical machine, and there is a capacity of each machine. We make sure we don't oversubscribe it too much. From a networking perspective, data is isolated on separate VLANs, so you know your tenant environment is isolated from others. There are other things we could talk about after, if you'd like. Thank you very much.
All right, up next, we have another live pitch. So if I can get the audience to take a seat, guys, we're... It's freeing up, so don't you worry. All right, so can we give a warm welcome of applause to Zach, and Corey from DashMD, guys.
Thanks. Next pitch.
Hi, everyone. Can you hear me okay? Great. My name is Zach Fish. I'm the CEO of DashMD, and we build patient engagement software that assists patients as they track and traverse their road to recovery after a visit to the emergency department. So that's me a few summers ago. As you can see, I have some way too personal experience with the emergency department. I broke my leg, I was rushed to the ED, a cast was put on, and as I was being discharged, I was given a ton of verbal information by my nurse, and I wasn't able to take any of it in because I was stressed, I was tired, I was medicated, and I didn't really end up learning anything new about my care. I also wasn't recommended any physio sources in my community in the event that I needed physiotherapy, which of course I did. So I get home, I start experiencing this excruciating pain in my leg, goes on for weeks. I think it's just a normal part of the healing process. It wasn't. The cast was put on far too tightly, and I developed something called compartment syndrome as a result, which can result in loss of limb. Thankfully, that didn't happen. But the fact that it was even a possibility is a testament to the fact that patients deserve better, and we can do better. So here's how we're going to completely revolutionize the discharge process. So when patients are discharged from the emergency department, they're going to be given a small DashMD discharge card. It contains a few key elements on it. The first is download instructions for iOS and Android. The second is a series of checkboxes associated with different discharge plans, things like concussion care, fracture care, et cetera. The nurse or clinician at the point of discharge checks off the relevant box. The patient downloads DashMD, subscribes to the plan that's been selected for them, thereby unlocking a suite of task management tools and resources that are custom to their care needs and vetted by each of our hospital partners. Things like a medication manager, appointment manager, digitized discharge instructions, healthcare contact reminders, everything that the patient needs in a centralized hub is easily accessible with them whenever and wherever they are. We're also providing patients with access to community care sources. So for example, if a patient subscribes to the fracture care discharge plan, they'll have a pre-populated list of physio clinics nearby and other relevant healthcare service providers in the community. So the idea here is that we're going to be generating much more foot traffic for healthcare service providers while making sure that patients get the care that they need, recommended care that they need, outside of the hospital. So we're really bridging the gap between hospital and community-based care that currently exists. So in terms of value add, patients are our users. We're improving their quality of care, and we're shifting their role in the healthcare system from the traditional passive recipient to active participant. Hospitals are a distribution channel. We're improving the quality of care that their patients are seeing, that the quality of care that their patients receive, and we're giving them free software. I'll get to that in just a minute. And our key customers are these healthcare service providers in the community, the physiotherapist clinics. We're providing them with a direct channel to their primary target market, which is recently discharged emergency department patients. So here's how we keep the lights on. We give our hospitals our software for free. They distribute it to patients who use it for free. They track their recovery, and they use it to discover healthcare service providers in the community that are relevant to their care needs. those are our key customers. We charge them a $500 fee per month in exchange for driving more foot traffic to their doors, thereby increasing their revenues. So in terms of traction and target market, based off of the number of sponsors, community-based sponsors we've identified in the North American context, we're looking at a $19.5 billion annual total addressable market. In terms of our little chunk of that piece, right now we have three agreements in place with three hospitals in Toronto and the greater Toronto area. We're going to be piloting in their emergency departments this summer. We also have agreements in place at different stages with different healthcare resource partners in the community, some of which you can see right there. So in terms of competitive advantage, for our hospitals, there's a very low ask. Once we implement, it's essentially a drag and drop play. We require very little of their time after we've implemented in the emergency departments. For patients, we're not collecting anything that can be construed as personal health information in any capacity. We don't even have user accounts. There's no personal data that's collected on any of our patients. And for our clinics, our key customers, we're providing them once again with a direct channel to their primary target market, recently discharged emergency department patients. And our marketing potential is very strong. We're providing a touch point piece of marketing in the emergency department in the hospital, whereby nurses and doctors are instructing patients to download and use DashMD to their benefit. And that's a very strong value proposition from our customers. So in terms of timeline, we've been very busy. We're launching in our pilot sites this summer. We're going to be, the pilot will span the summer with our different pilot sites. At the end of the summer, once the pilot is concluded, we'd like to transition our relationship with our pilot hospitals into a more enduring relationship, whereby DashMD is a fixture in the emergency department discharge process. We're also going to be focusing on expanding south of the border into additional hospitals, into other care ecosystems across our different hospital partners. And we also are going to be focusing on signing on more of those community sponsors, those key customers, so that we can increase our cash flow. So this is our team. We have a very unique cross-pollination of skill sets from engineering, design, legal, business, and healthcare expertise. We also have been lucky enough to surround ourselves with great partners. We're members of the upcoming Next 36 cohort this summer. And lastly, we are DashMD. Our mission, more than anything else, is to connect the dots in healthcare. Thank you. Appreciate it. Be happy to answer any questions.
I guess there's no microphone. Can you go over again how the value proposition works for the group that actually pays you, the clinic sponsor?
Yeah, absolutely. So their contact information is basically listed on our software. So for example, when a patient is discharged, they have to subscribe to the discharge plan that's been selected for them. So let's say the nurse checks off fracture care. So the patient subscribes to the fracture care discharge plan, and then within DashMD, they're provided with a list of recommendations, contact information basically, you can see it there, associated with the contact section of our app, as well as different specific tasks that are recommended to the patient. And within those different tasks and within the contact section, the patient is basically being served with recommendations for local healthcare service providers.
So they still choose. They're not, their information is not given to those clinics, and then those clinics can then push any kind of notification or contact to them. Is they still choose from this list of
options. That's correct. That's right. So it's targeted to specific patients given their specific conditions, which based off of our customer development, our healthcare service providers love. It's a lot more targeted than something like Google Ads or Yelp or Yellow Pages. Yeah. So it's a direct channel essentially.
And second question, then I'll shut up. Have you seen anybody else? How would you characterize competitive landscape? Because I've heard of a company called Seamless MD that's doing something very similar.
Yep.
So how do you kind of compare against them?
Sure. So great that you brought up Seamless. They're actually a prior Next 36 company. We compete on two different spectrums, in my opinion. The first is patient engagement, so making sure that the patient has an improved quality of care as a result of using this. And the second is lead generation. So specific to Seamless, they focus on post-op care, whereas we're focusing on more short-term acute care from the emergency department. Something else that Seamless does that we do not do is facilitate communication between the provider and the patient. We pride ourselves on the fact that we don't. Emergency department doctors don't have the time to take away from the resources that they are spending on patients in hospital and dedicate those to patients that have left the hospital, which is our focus. Because if they're doing that, then patients in hospital aren't getting the care that they need. So we're not facilitating that communication. And as for the lead generation, nobody else in Toronto, and to the best of our knowledge, in any emergency department in North America is doing this.
You mentioned that you have three pilots running in hospitals this summer, but what's the buy-in from the hospitals, and what's the reason that, say, nurses would take this on? Because you mentioned your clients are actually, like, say, physiotherapists. physiotherapy clinics. Mm-hmm. So, like, what is the, you know, how do you get the buy-in from the hospitals? Because there's nothing really in it for them per se.
Yeah. So from their perspective, the ROI equation is shifted significantly, given that we're giving this to them for free. It's really a matter of, to them, are patients using it and do they like it? And if it's improving the care that patients are receiving, or that the care that patients are receiving, then that's sufficient for the hospitals from their perspective, because it's a tool that is not currently offered. The discharge process in the emergency department has not been innovated upon in decades. It's remained fairly static. And in their eyes, they see this as simply the natural evolution of the discharge process. Should I take questions?
Do you have anything in place to help the hospitals quantify the impact in terms of, you know, fewer repeat visits, fewer medications being used, anything like that?
Mm-hmm. So for the moment, we're going to be focusing on usability stats with our hospitals. So at the moment, we do not, but we are planning on conducting research studies as we transition from pilot, which is basically just to determine, are patients using it? Are they getting value out of it? Are patients discovering healthcare community sources through DashMD? And moving forward, we'll be able to collect larger metrics. But in order to actually determine whether this is reducing readmissions, which is not a part of our current value proposition, but moving forward, perhaps it may be, we need to have a very large sample size. And that takes a lot of time beyond the 3-month pilot that we're launching this summer. Can I take audience questions?
Any more questions from the panel? Okay, we can take maybe one audience question.
Okay. Yes?
You say the estimated annual market is $19.5 billion. Is that worldwide or just U.S. and Canada?
This is North American only.
Can you be number one, two, or three? Or is that your ambition? Because if you're not, you're going to be bought.
We want to be number one, two, and three.
And do you have a plan how to do that?
We do. So basically, the benefit of our revenue model is that, can I keep going? Can I finish this question? Thank you. The benefit of our revenue model is that it allows us to expand geographically and also from a revenue standpoint outside the confines of the hospital. Typically, healthcare software vendors charge the hospital directly. In our opinion, that's not scalable. We don't want to deal with the RFPs. It's a lengthy process. If we partner with these healthcare service providers in the community, we're able to expand outside the hospital and generate a lot more revenue. And it's a very, very easy way to do that. It's very easy to do that once we're embedded in the hospital. So in terms of distribution plans, get into the hospital first and then populate ourselves into the community by partnering with those service providers. Okay. All right, thank you very much.
So I'm just going to call my panel because they're sitting outside, guys. All right. All right, so the next panel will be on the evolution of startups in Canada. It will include David Thomas from QuickBooks. It will also include Camille McInnes from Startup Canada lead, but also she leads marketing at Square Canada. She also does a lot of things, Startup Weekend. You know, if you guys need to hook up in the startup community, you can reach out to Camille. Also, Lyndon, who is founder of Communications Bar, and he's a PR guru. And also Julian Sanchez from BDC. And Chris Maida, who's a board member of Maple Leaf Angels, and obviously an angel investor. So please give them a round, please applaud. Thank you. So just to give you a brief bio on our moderator, David Thomas. So Dave is the Senior Marketing Manager with Intuit QuickBooks Online Segment. He's an experienced integrated marketer who works with small businesses, startups, to bring them to a full-service online accounting solution. So without further ado.
Thank you. No, I don't need the questions.
He said he's going to switch all the questions on us. Yeah, so we tried to prepare, and now he's...
I've thrown them all out the window anyway.
So get ready for something interesting.
So thanks, everyone, for sticking around for this chat. Hopefully you guys find it informative. There'll be time at the end for questions for all of these guys if you have them. So we've used our time on this tour a little bit differently than some of the other sponsors. I don't have a deck to tell you how awesome QuickBooks is. Stop by the booth and I can tell you that. But we really believe in the startup ecosystem and the ecosystem that needs to surround entrepreneurs for them to be successful, both at their company level and then as a community as a whole. And so that kind of ladders up to the role that QuickBooks plays for your company. It kind of sits in the middle. It's like an operating system for your business. And then we have a whole ecosystem of apps that plug in, and we work with accountants, and we work with government, and all these people to help you grow your business and start it successfully. So we've been doing this chat all across Canada. This is the 12th or 11th one. Stop. How many places have we been, Randy? This is 9. It's a blur. So we've been doing this chat across Canada with different members of each community, and it's been really interesting to kind of hear the challenges of each ecosystem and where they are in their growth cycle and where they are, what the problems that they're facing, and what are the good parts and what are the bad parts. And they've varied from coast to coast, to be honest. And we're seeing trends around kind of the bigger, more developed cities and what kind of issues they're having and what they need to do to bring it together. And we've seen it conversely with the smaller ones as well. So without further ado, let's introduce the panel. I've got a really hard-hitting question I'm going to lead off with right now. Who are you and what do you do?
I'm Camille McInnes, and I'm here today on behalf of Startup Canada. So what Startup Canada does is it's like an umbrella organization for all the startup communities across Canada. Essentially with the goal, it's a grassroots movement to help entrepreneurs get connected with the resources they need.
Hi, so I'm Lyndon Johnson, and there is no B in the middle right now, although that may change. And I've got a business called Comms Bar. It's like a genius bar, like an Apple Genius Bar, where entrepreneurs can come and get the advice they need in order to use public relations, marketing, and publicity to grow their businesses. And it's really as simple as that. We're just trying to make it accessible, because right now, a lot of the options are beyond the reach of most entrepreneurs, and we believe that entrepreneurs should be able to use the disciplines, and we're there to help.
I'm Chris Maida. I'm with representing Maple Leaf Angels. We are a Toronto angel group that's affiliated with Mars, and my personal background is I did a marketing automation startup in the Valley in the 90s, and then fell in love with a Canadian, and here I am. And so besides Maple Leaf Angels, I have a software company in marketing automation.
Great. So I'm Julian Sanchez with the Business Development Bank of Canada. We're a crown corporation that's dedicated to working with small and medium entrepreneurs across the country. And our role is, we do have the venture capital arm, we have a financing arm, we have a consulting arm. And the idea is to just try to find ways to help companies accelerate their growth. I work a lot with technology companies in Toronto. And then the other kind of leg of the stool, how we provide support is similar to a lot of people in the ecosystem, is just trying to make connections to relevant government programs, relevant partners, sometimes possible customers as well. But really just to try to be there as a fulcrum for whatever you guys are trying to do with your business.
Great, thanks. So let's start off with kind of a level set and figure out where we're at. So since you now have the microphone, Camille, I'll start with you. How do you see the current landscape right now, the startup ecosystem in Toronto?
Toronto's an interesting ecosystem.
Startup Toronto itself as a community organization is very new compared to others across Canada. However, Toronto itself is a very old startup ecosystem. We have very entrenched and established players like Mars, but you have a lot of grassroots things happening as well, like TechTO. So there's a lot of diversity and available resources out there, a lot of competition in the events and the offerings that are offered to startups. Probably the best description I have.
Lyndon, what's your perspective as an entrepreneur in the community?
Well, I've been here 5 years, and so my perspective is kind of limited to that time frame. But what I see is a maturity over those 5 years. I've seen that it's changed. And I think that everybody talks about trying to create the next Silicon Valley. And I think what I've seen over the last few years, the last couple in particular, is that Toronto's learning from some of the best communities around the world and trying to bring together all of those kind of best traits, all of the best practice from different communities to try to create this kind of hub. I would say it's still a little bit too tech heavy. I'd like to see a little bit more for companies that aren't technical through their product or service. They use technology as part of their business, but that isn't what they sell. But I think, you know, what I've seen means that we're going in the right direction.
Chris, any thoughts from...
Yeah, I think when I started investing in Toronto about 5 years ago, it was a very sleepy place. There weren't very many good companies. There was not a lot of, infrastructure. I think in the last 5 years, we've seen a lot of good companies coming out of the incubators. There have been some exits. We've had to become much more sophisticated and quicker in the way we make decisions. So we've gone from, the sleepy traditional angel model where you have to herd cats to actually having a fund where we can make quick decisions. And I think the best companies I've seen in Toronto have been able to, sort of leverage the strengths of being in Canada while still having very good ties with the Valley and Boston. So I think I'm very optimistic, and we're very optimistic about the Toronto ecosystem.
And Julian, any thoughts on the current landscape?
Yeah, I think one of the big things that's changed, especially with the BDC, is because we've seen such a big growth in technology companies in the city, we've tried hard to keep up and find different ways to fund the earlier stages. Because what we were finding was there's a real focus on kind of finding angels and VC investment for companies that could use debt to grow their company as well and maybe push it down the line a bit further. And it's something that, even with some of the changes we've made, we have a new president, and that's one of his big focuses. How do we finance more startups in this sector in a way that helps them kind of push the line and also resist that temptation to go to Silicon Valley or go to Boston and try to keep those companies growing in Canada?
So let's start with some of the current challenges, either from the perspective down here who are helping fund and start these businesses, or from the entrepreneurs, or from the community. Chris, you've got the mic, so you've got to answer first.
I lost the hot potato game. So the question is, how to get fund companies
well
off the ground?
What do you see as some of the challenges right now within the ecosystem, from your perspective, from kind of where you're coming from?
If I was an entrepreneur in this ecosystem, I think it's very easy to find small amounts of money in the form of grants and things like that. It's harder to find, sort of six-figure and up investments because the valuations are much lower here compared to the Valley. The bar is higher in terms of the kind of traction and revenue you have to show. So, for angel groups, that's great because a lot of stuff gets de-risked and we get low prices, but you have to work a lot harder as an entrepreneur here to get funding.
Lyndon, what do you see as some of the challenges as an entrepreneur right now?
I think as a non-tech entrepreneur, I think that it's a challenge to find resources that are designed to help me because I don't have a technology product. I'm delivering a service, and so talking to a lot of the investment community about getting some money to really step up the growth is difficult. Finding events to go to where the topic isn't about technology, that's a real challenge. And I think that having more of a breadth, because there are people that are running startups that are technically small business owners, but they don't see themselves as being relevant to what's going on in the city right now. And I think that for all of the great technology businesses there are, they've got to have people to use what they're developing. And they are these non-tech businesses. And unless we develop those at the same level that we develop the tech businesses, we're going to run into a problem down the line. So I would like more resources that are focused on entrepreneurs that aren't building tech businesses. That would really help me.
That's interesting. Camille, it's your turn.
So being part of like a community and being a community leader, we work a lot with entrepreneurs, with angels, with investors, with partners. And probably the biggest thing we see not only in Toronto but across Canada from entrepreneurs and the biggest challenge is a lot of early stage entrepreneurs who have an idea but want funding with only an idea. And so it's really about trying to educate them on how to get their first customers and how to get traction, because without those things and without proper validation, they're not going to get funding. And so it's educating them to go out and hustle to get those first customers and build the model, because otherwise there's not really a point in sending them to the Chris's of the world, and we're not going to get that growth that we want entrepreneurs to have or the success that they should have. So it's that early stage education.
One of the trends that we saw in some of the bigger centers across Canada when we asked kind of that question was the bigger and more developed the ecosystem was, the less likely all the parts were to kind of play nice in the sandbox. Whereas the smaller communities kind of seemed to all bind together, and you know, it was this forward pushing movement where in the bigger spots there was a lot of competition between the people who were trying to help or these organizations.
I love that. Do it. Because the bad stuff will
get for the microphone.
I can talk loud enough.
I know that, but
the bad stuff will die and it should be allowed to die. Like, it's like a rainforest where if something dies, it will then become like the nutrient that feeds the next tree and allows the whole ecosystem to grow and thrive. Like, let the bad stuff go to the bottom and the good stuff rise to the top. There should be competition, because when you get too many players who are kumbaya and let's all, you know, we shouldn't go up against each other, and we should try and all provide the same thing. You get people who are complacent, who don't provide valuable events or quality events and education then to entrepreneurs, and it just becomes a waste, I think.
But what about the counter argument to that is if there's too much programming, if there's too many events, if there's an oversaturation for entrepreneurs and they don't know how to divide their time or which ones they're supposed to go to or which ones are actually useful?
They will learn, and people will decide. They'll go and they just won't go to that again, and they won't tell their friends to go to that. The customers will decide.
Lyndon's ready. He wants to talk.
No, I was just going to say that I spend an increasing amount of time in Detroit, and you see what they're doing there, because they're building from scratch. They have literally nothing, so they're building retail, they're building a community physically, and they're also trying to build a system that has the resources to help the community grow. And I think that it does find a natural rhythm. People know where to go for certain things. But if we're looking anywhere at a startup community, I would say look at what Detroit's doing, because you go in there, and if they're not the right starting point, they will pass you to whoever is the most appropriate starting point for you, where you can get the help that you need. There are none of the gatekeepers now, because ultimately if one organization wins but everybody else fails, the whole thing fails. So right now they're focused on building a community, building an ecosystem, and they're learning that the only way to do that is where everyone plays to help support each other.
Flipping the table from kind of the issues to the bright side. What makes Toronto a unique ecosystem for startups, and like what's going well? Tell us something good. Chris, tell us something good. You got all the money.
So I think that's all good.
could go, you know, could be taken out or go public in the next few years. So I think, you know, things are going well. The incubators are turning out good stuff. I mean, okay, so Maple Leaf Angels, we started a fund because we were like, because if I'm an angel and I hate raising money with angels because they're so freaking slow. So we're like, being slow may not be good. So we said, let's do a fund so we can make quick decisions. And then we started like cruising all the incubators and we started finding really good companies. And so we've done like 4 or 5 investments in the last year. We're raising a second fund and things are going well. So we're very optimistic about the ecosystem. We want, you know, more entrepreneurs who can get traction and get revenue so that we can invest in them. But I think, you know, the bar is if you don't have revenue, we're not interested. So.
Yeah, I think to the point of the ecosystem, competition's good. But one of the good things I think in Toronto we found is that there is quite a bit of collaboration. So there's people that are genuinely interested in getting to know entrepreneurs and directing them in the right path. So, for example, I know Daniel Klass has referred clients over to us to do debt financing because what it does is helps them get further down the line. You know, it's someone that they keep track on, then they can invest once they've kind of more fully proven out their model and we can help to de-risk it. But even for us, I know a big role for us is to get to know the entrepreneur as well as possible and what they're planning on so that we can make those connections. And I think that network aspect of the ecosystem is quite strong in Toronto.
Anyone down here? Do you have anything nice to say, Camille? Oh, you do? Okay, good.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Like I'm the bad one.
Go ahead.
Similar to what Chris was saying, and actually this is like a unknown little fact about Toronto, but every year in San Francisco or Techstars now, there's something called Global Startup Battle. And it's all of the startup weekends across the globe send their best people or the best companies that have come out of startup weekends to battle at this event. And the last 2 years, and it's only been running for 2 years, the last 2 years that it's been run, the winners have both been from Toronto. So there are good ideas. There are people who have good ideas and who do have that drive and want to be successful. And we're seeing more of that now coming out of Toronto. So
great. Let's switch from the community as a whole and the ecosystem as a whole to the individual entrepreneur and the importance of building an ecosystem around your business. And where do you start? Lyndon, you are nodding in agreement, so I'm going to make you answer.
Yeah, you start with people you know. And that's one of the things that a lot of entrepreneurs overlook is that as going through the process of building the business, they will identify the people that matter, the people that will help them to grow it. But when they start to look at promoting their business, once they've got it up and running, they then go and try and talk to as many people as possible, not realizing that the people that are going to help them to grow, the revenue, the people that can introduce them to potential customers are within their existing network. A lot of entrepreneurs forget that. They don't look inside that existing network. You've already been through the process of explaining what you're doing. You've already found the people that have a need. You found people that could be potential partners. But then it becomes a numbers game. You know, they want to go out and, you know, be on Mashable or TechCrunch rather than actually looking at who within their network, because word of mouth as you're starting is really the thing that's going to get you to that point where you can scale. You have a group, you have a community, an ecosystem where you can communicate to them en masse via mass media outlets, but start looking within your own network first.
Chris, any thoughts on what kind of partners or mentors or influencers that will help make an entrepreneur make their business stronger right off the start?
One answer is it depends on the kind of business. So, I mean, you basically want mentors who have been there before and have seen made the mistakes so you don't have to make them again. I think, you know, for the entrepreneur, it's important to be, you know, outgoing and build those connections and keep up on them because, you know, the people who have the best network and maintain it tend to do much better than the introverted nerds who kind of stay at home and look at their computer.
He looked right at me when he said introverted nerd.
Yeah, I think just to echo Lyndon's thoughts, sometimes entrepreneurs don't put enough focus on the easiest people to reach, and trying to exploit every bit of advantage you can get from them. Introduction to potential clients, introduction to potential investors, some guidance on other players. I think one of the big ones entrepreneurs sometimes we find is they have a bit of tunnel vision, and they get focused on there's one specific way to grow, and they're not as open to other alternatives, or they're not as aware of some of the support that's in place in terms of government programs and that. And I think that's where having a kind of a varied network brings a lot of benefit, because you're not drawing just from a couple people's experience, but you're drawing from a large group.
One last topic to touch on before we open it up for questions, and it's come up on every single stop, and that's mentorship. And unanimously everyone says, yes, you need a mentor. Mentors are great, and they're the best thing that's ever happened, so go get one. And then the follow-up question is always, okay, how do I do that? And so, yes, mentors are great, and everyone needs one, but how do I go and get one? How do I find one? Anyone?
Yeah, I think a big part of it is identifying what do you want that mentor to bring to your business, right? Like, is taking an honest evaluation of what you and your team, what skill sets you and your team have and where you're deficient. And a part of it is, like I said, trying to figure out, if you're weaker on some of the technical side, or if you're weaker on the sales and marketing side, or if you're lacking, the kind of network you think you need to tap into, I think that's the first step. And then kind of drawing up a list of people that you think can fill that role. And the tough part is, reaching out to them and finding a way to build that relationship and kind of establish what you each want to get out of it. But I think the first step is figuring out what gaps in your business are they helping fill.
Lyndon, do you have a mentor?
I do, yeah, who continually kind of kicks my backside, about things that I should be doing. But I think one of the things is asking. A lot of the time, you identify who they are. Oftentimes people want to be asked. They're just waiting for you to ask them to help, because if you're recognizing them as somebody that's been through what you're going through and can add value, there are very few entrepreneurs that I know that don't want to give back, that don't want to help people to do what they've done. So the biggest barrier sometimes is just asking, saying, look, I recognize what you've done, this is what I'm doing, and this is the value that I could see, maybe mutually. There's a 10,000 Coffees, which is a platform that is in Canada, in Toronto in particular. And talking with some of the guys from there, they were saying that it's designed for the next generation to find mentors from people that are already running businesses. But actually, a lot of the feedback that they've had is from the seasoned executives saying, actually, talking to the next generation, they got insights that they don't get in their existing network. And that has huge value. And so oftentimes you'll find people wanting to reciprocate.
Yeah. Camille, thoughts on mentorship before we open it up?
Most important, one of the most important things. And I recommend doing two things, getting peer mentors. So people who are going through the same thing you're going through, because they're a support, and you guys can talk about how you have the same problems or the same successes and work through those together. And then having the more senior type mentors where it might be we're lacking a certain skill. And sometimes the best way to find them is just identify who you would want. Maybe you're a financial company and you want like the CEO of Wealthsimple to be your mentor. And see who in your network on LinkedIn is connected to that person. Ask for an intro and say, hey, Michael, I would really like to take you out for a cup of coffee and just hear about your background and how you got started. Start to build that relationship. You can go to events and meet people, tell them what you're doing, tell them what you're about, and let them know that you're looking for mentors, and if they know anyone in that kind of area. And that's how you can start building your network and finding these people.
Great. Okay, so let's take the next 5 or so minutes and we'll open it up to the floor. I'll give you my microphone.
Thanks. So we only have time for 2 questions. How convenient.
I had 2, but maybe that's not fair, so I'll ask one. In terms of the ecosystem here, by sector, what's Toronto really, really strong in. I'll slip in my second question anyway, and most entrepreneurs I talk to have trouble finding the sales marketing people in this ecosystem. And do you have any advice or insight on how to improve that situation?
I'm happy to go with part one, and Lyndon can go to part two. At a government level, at a city level, there's been a lot of focus on medical and fintech in Toronto. I think there's a lot outside of that that's valuable and that we're seeing thrive here, but that generally seems to be a focus here.
So in terms of sales and marketing, I think that there's an awful lot of options, but actually one of the best ways to do it is to learn a process that you can use and replicate. People think that there's an art to it, and in reality it's process. It's learning how to do it. And I do a lot of things with building relationships, and people want to outsource the relationships to another company and say, but if I was outsourcing my relationship with my wife to a third party, or I was relying on two different people, you know, I had to get somebody to pass on the message I wanted, and then there was a gatekeeper that, you know, my wife's best friend, if she didn't like the message, she wouldn't pass it on. I lose that relationship with my wife. And it's the same with customers, it's the same with journalists, it's the same with investors. Anybody that matters to your business, you should be doing it yourself. And it's really what, you know, we try and help entrepreneurs with, is to actually understand that it's not an art, it's something that they can learn, and actually they're the best people to do it at the early stages, because they get to have those direct conversations, and most importantly, they get to hear the questions that get asked. And they're the best people to answer the questions. You know, Camille knows a lot about my business, but she probably couldn't answer all of the questions that, you know, somebody would want to know about it. And if you build a relationship, if I'd have sent my best friend on dates with my wife, I wouldn't be married to her now. You know, it's about that process of going through building the relationships, because that's ultimately how businesses grow.
I think, you know, to net out the sales and marketing, I think if you're an early stage startup in Toronto, you have no choice but to work with what you've got locally. Once you've got funding, I mean, I was on the board of a company that once they got funding, they just started hiring sales and marketing in Boston and product management in Silicon Valley. So, you know, if you've got the financial resources, you can go hire the best. Until then, you've got to do it yourself. It's, you know, if it's worth doing, it's worth doing badly. So you've got to do it.
Question, sorry. No? Okay, I can make it kind of more specific. This is more of a question for Chris. I'm the owner of a startup. What's kind of the minimum that a startup would come to you, and then you'd say, oh, I'm interested because you guys already have this? What's that first thing?
Really, to be fundable, it has to have traction, and traction today really means revenue, unless you're a certain kind of consumer business where you monetize late in the cycle. So the four companies we funded, three had revenue. One did not have revenue because their business plan, they're a mobile app, so their business plan was increase user engagement as fast as possible, and they had 200,000 of credits from Microsoft to fund that, and so they didn't have to monetize for a year, but they were showing user engagement and growth numbers that were kind of, you know, going through the roof, so we were okay with that. So it's really, you don't get funded with a PowerPoint deck these days, especially as a first-time entrepreneur. You've really got to have something built and have some sort of market acceptance.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Yeah, you can applaud. Thank you to our panelists. So, guys, I have some very cool news for you. Lunch is ready, but we'll ask you all to go grab a lunch. We're going to have our keynote at 12:40, so Michael Hyatt from CBC Dragon's Den Next Gen. He'll start at 12:40, and we're going to be locking the doors just because we don't want people to come in and out. So go grab lunch, network, come back, see you in 20. Enjoy.